Today charged with trafficking in a controlled drug after a police raid at Black Forest yesterday. Detectives searched the property on Cowper Road and discovered evidence of drug dealing, including an amount of heroin and $32,000 in cash. A 50-year-old woman and a 49-year-old man, both from Black Forest, were refused bail. The former US gymnastics doctor convicted of sexually assaulting athletes has been stabbed in jail. Larry Nass is now in a stable condition after being stabbed in the neck, back and chest. During his court proceedings, more than 150 women and girls came forward to say he'd sexually abused them. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Get 10-year warranty and 10 years capped price servicing on the new Mitsubishi Outlander at Agostino Mitsubishi.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide's players will train at Alberton this morning as they prepare for Saturday's Twilight Clash against Carlton at Marvel Stadium. Much attention will be on whether Scott Lycett is fit after the ruckman has missed the past two games with a knee injury. The Crows will also do some work at West Lakes and will be looking to bounce back following a disappointing loss against Essendon. Let's stick with footy, and AFL great Matthew Lloyd is calling out the decision not to move Saturday's match between Geelong and Essendon to the MCG. Only about 24,000 fans will be able to attend the game of the round, and that's due to ongoing works at Kidinnea Park. Lloyd says he's disappointed to see the league is missing a huge opportunity.
How good would it be to have the MCG, I'm not talking Marvel, the MCG, because it's Geelong's home game, 75,000 at the MCG. The first game's Collingwood v Fremantle. It's a 1:45 game. Clear them all out by 4:30, 5 o'clock, and then the Bombers v the Cats in front of that huge crowd would be amazing.
To tennis now, Stefanos Tsitsipas has suffered a shock fourth-round loss to Chris Eubanks at Wimbledon. Better news, though, for Carlos Alcaraz, who came from a set down to beat Matteo Berrettini in four. And English fast bowler Mark Wood is confident he will be fit enough to play in the remaining two Ashes tests. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now the 5AA Forecast.
Pack away the bikinis and boardies, pull out the woolies and get your brakes checked at Automasters.
Mostly sunny, a high of 17 today. More of the same on Wednesday and Thursday, tops of 17. And partly cloudy for Friday, also 17. At the moment, 12. More news as it happens on 5AA.
5AA Breakfast.
Good morning to you. It is minus 0.6 in Canberra right now.
Thank God we're not there.
Good morning to you, Will Goodings.
Good morning to you, Luce. Crikey, minus 0.6.
To all those flying to Canberra today on the red-eye flights or you're going over there to do business, good luck to you. Good luck to you. Shame you're not going to Darwin. Currently 24.1 in Darwin.
See, I just wonder how different Australia is as a country if we had Parliament House in Darwin compared to Canberra.
I wonder what the general mood would be in Parliament.
Yeah. It might be less productive, I suspect.
Yeah, shorter days.
No ties. The whole thing would look very relaxed.
Thongs and shorts.
I'm just convinced really super cold weather makes people highly strung.
Hello, have you met me?
I wasn't going to... Present company accepted, obviously.
No, I am clearly highly strung in this cold weather, but that's all right. It's not actually too bad here in Adelaide. We're going for a top of 17 and mostly sunny, so I'll take that any day of the week in July. Our big show on the way, it is Tuesday, which means Phil Currie talking of Canberra. Lucky Phil, we can ask him how he's holding up this winter. Olivia Savas, the member for Newland, joining us to talk about yet another post office that's set to close. And I can imagine that people will not be in favour of this. Claire Shuttleworth talking about the Port Adelaide National Trust, a heritage building potentially on the list. And of course, our trial by jury and my movie review of Monty Python.
Looking forward to that a little bit later. I'm really interested in this chat we're going to have with the Heritage Trust just before 7 o'clock today. Because often we have these conversations in the context of things that are slated for development or removal, and it's controversial because it'll be seen by some people as an old building with limited utility, making in the way of maybe a big development that's going to be provide some broader community benefit or some economic benefit. But I was thinking this morning, I generally think they get it right, the heritage people. And I was wondering, can you think off the top of your head a heritage-listed building or place in your suburb? Because we've got a Charles Sturt the museum, Charles Sturt House in Grange, that's a couple of streets over from me in Jetty Street. It's more than a house. It's almost a historic home, but all the surrounding gardens and things. It's beautiful. You can walk through there. There's no fence. You can come off Jetty Road. You can walk through the park. You walk along the creek there. And it's spectacular. And I was wondering, and I'd love to hear from our listeners on 8223 0000. Text us on the Dutton's text line. What is the heritage listed thing in your suburb? What could be something that's controversial. Could be something that you really like. That is something that it's not controversial. It'd be an absolute tragedy if it got knocked down. But I tend to think we focus so much on the controversial issues that the Heritage Council gets involved in, and don't talk about the fact that 95% of these things are probably unarguable. So let's, ahead of that conversation at 7, talk about some of them in your neck of the woods. 8223 0000. Anything come to mind for you, Luz?
Yeah, up in the northeast, the Tea Tree Gully, the museum, where it was old Tea Tree Gully, a lot of that area, there's this, the old St. Agnes Brewery, I think. A lot of vines that got knocked down. It's where a lot of the Locans came from. I call it Locanville.
Is that right?
Yes. And now I'm a resident up there. But yeah, there is a lot of heritage up in the Tea Tree Gully area. And you can go in and see this little museum, which is very small. It looks just like a workshop from a blacksmith, I guess. Yeah, I don't know a lot about South Australian history, which is a huge gap in my knowledge, but it's nice that we do celebrate suburb-wise as well. I think that's really important.
I've just got a theory, every suburb's got one. I just want to test that this morning.
Yeah.
You're waking up.
Yeah.
Surely you've got an old thing that you're proud of in your area. Sam Datto has wandered in. Morning to you, Sam.
Morning, guys. On that theme, Hendon. The suburb I come from, It was the site of Adelaide's first aerodrome.
Is that right? Before, well, like cycling?
No, planes.
Oh, for planes.
Before Parafield
Velodrome
took over.
Is what I was thinking of.
Yeah, velodrome.
They are one and the same.
And it's not a site or location you can go to now, but all the streets around there are named after planes and people who used that aerodrome back in the day. The Hendon Aerodrome, that's mine.
Which is extraordinary. You wouldn't, yeah. I guess the airport ultimately is not too far away from Hendon.
Yeah.
So the aerodrome in Hendon. So what's an example of the street name?
One of them, Circuit Drive, pretty sure. And they're named after plane brands and names like de Havilland and stuff like that.
There's an area in sort of Henley Beach. No, it's probably one over from Henley Beach. Henley Beach, but let's say broadly in that area south, where all the street names are named after Australian naval vessels, and I have no idea why. No idea why. It's a relatively new sort of development in there. But I just drive around there and go, oh, there's another one. Oh, there's no explanation. There are lots of little old historic sort of stories like that around Adelaide.
Actually, I think a few streets around my street are named after former prime ministers. We've got Menzies Avenue.
Is that right?
Yeah. My mum pointed that out the other day. I'm sure they're like that in every suburb.
But I have to come up with a name somehow. Maybe you've got a cluster of curious street names in your area. I'd love to hear from people who... Mysteries solved and unsolved this morning as well on 8223 0000.
Or do you have a street named after you? I mean, there's
King William Street.
There's a lot of like Smith Streets. There's a lot of Smiths in the world, but if you do have your last name is on a street that's a bit unusual, or up Alexander Hill up in the Riverland. He's one of Australia's rowers. He's got Alexander Hill Road up in Loxton, I think now.
You have to have reached a certain level of achievement, I think, to get a street named after you.
Yeah, I mean, being an Olympic gold medalist rower,
that'll do it.
That probably will do it. But text us all morning, folks, 0448 08 1395. That is the Dutton's text line. Volkswagen, Tiguan Allspace, the 7-seater that's perfect for weekends away, camping trips and the crazy Saturday sports rush. Or even better, give us a call, 8223 0000. We'd love to hear your calls this morning. It is 12 minutes past 6. We'll get to your news headlines after this.
If you're a business-savvy business traveller, you should know. With Virgin Australia Business Flyer, you'll earn up to $1,000 for your business to use on future flights, for a limited time only. It's just another way to keep your bottom line flying high. Apply today at virginaustralia.com/businessvalue. For new members only, must sign up and fly on eligible flights within 30 days. Offer ends 7th of August 2023. T's and C's apply.
I noticed about 3 years ago that Mum started to really struggle with managing the house and needed some support.
I've always been very independent and felt guilty of relying on the family to help so much.
So we had a chat and then we got in touch with Avaya, and they were able to guide Mum on how to access home care services.
And now when you come over, we have lovely time together. Yeah. And it's just our time.
Care to talk retirement living care options? Call Aveo on 13 28 36 or search Aveo Care to Talk.
I'm on the street for Listerine. Toothbrush, dental floss and Listerine Total Care. Which offers the best oral hygiene?
Toothbrush?
Brush? Listerine.
Brush and Listerine.
Close. It's brush, floss, Listerine. See, Listerine's five times more effective than floss at reducing plaque above the gum line when used for 12 weeks consistently.
Cool. Any freebies?
Do the disclaimer first.
Listerine Total Care. Use only as directed.
Here at 5AA, we're all about supporting local. Here's who you can support around Adelaide. For total knee, hip and shoulder replacement, see the Joint Replacement Clinic. Renewing mobility, restoring life. Visit thejointreplacementclinic.com.au. Looking to get away this winter? Save your cold hard cash with Adelaide Custom Caravan's huge winter stock clearance. Adelaide Custom Caravans, South Road, Darlington. 5AA, supporting local business.
5AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
The Cherry Emoda 5, state-of-the-art driving from 33K drive away with immediate delivery. Visit Cherry Glen Osmond.
I'm going to jump on the Foodland Supermarkets Facebook and YouTube live stream this morning. Leave your thoughts. We'd love to hear your heritage-listed buildings in your suburb. Lisa says Nova Gardens has Cummins House tucked away in a back street. It's nice when you drive down a back street and you discover something like that.
We did a play once at Cummins House, actually, when I was at Emmanuel College. It was the site of, I can't remember what we did there. I think it was some form of Shakespeare, but it's a spectacular backdrop there, Lisa. This one's interesting. Someone's got a cluster of streets named after Riverland Town. So Loxton Street, I presume. I don't know what the suffix is, but Barmera, Pomputa. I'm not familiar with Pomputa. But Loxton and Barmera and other sort of Riverland towns. 8223 0000, or you can text us on the Duttons text line. Let's get into the news headlines on this, the 11th of July. Households are winding back spending on travel, gyms, cafes and entertainment as cost of living pressures take a toll. The Commonwealth Bank Household Spending Intentions Index fell 1.7% in June as consumer activity weakened across a range of categories. Fascinated to hear now news headlines on the way in, Luce. 13% of people think the federal government's doing enough to deal with cost of living pressures. Who are these 13% of people? Are they 13% of people? I was fascinated by this. I sat there and thought, it can't be 13% of people who go, they've got it handled. It can only be, tell me if I'm wrong, folks, 13% of people go, I'm not affected by cost of living pressures, and as such, well, I don't want money to be spent fixing a problem that doesn't affect me. It's got to be. It goes to show nothing's 100% these days.
I was going to say, it's those who it doesn't affect, clearly. They're comfortable enough that they don't notice things like bread going up or eggs going up, which we'll chat about later. So it's those that don't want money spent, you're right, on a problem that doesn't affect them. But for that still to be 13%, that's still surprising.
More than 1 in 10. Australia is sending sophisticated surveillance planes to further support Ukraine's defence. Up to 100 Defence Force personnel will be based in Germany for 6 months. Ukrainian MP Kira Rudik has told the Today Show this morning, all weapons and supplies make a huge difference because they're fighting a strong enemy.
The planes are critically important for us. It's additional level of security for the peaceful cities. It's additional support for our army. And I cannot begin to thank to Australian people and Australian government for these decisions.
You hear from Prime Minister Anthony Albanese after 7 o'clock on 5AA Breakfast about that announcement. A former independent MP says former Prime Minister Scott Morrison must respond to the findings of the Robo-Debt Royal Commission. Mr Morrison has rejected the findings from the inquiry, which has been condemned as crude and cruel. The scheme unlawfully and incorrectly demand welfare recipients pay back their benefits. Rex Patrick says it's not Mr Morrison's first issue.
One of the things that is holding back the Liberal Party now, the conduct of Scott Morrison that ranged from a whole suite of different things that he did, secret ministries, things like sports rorts, those sorts of things.
The average lifespan in Australia has increased by 12 months every 4 years since the start of the 20th century. Well, you do the maths on that one, Luce.
Well,
that's according to a new report by the Australian Institute of Health and Welfare. Spokesperson Richard Duke says more people are living longer, but the maximum age we're living has barely moved.
So less and less Australians are dying at younger ages, and more Australians are reaching ages 80, 90 or 100. It's just that we're not getting much beyond that.
Well, that's an interesting quirk of the statistics. In a big part of the 19th, the 20th century, the huge gains made in life expectancy weren't actually people living older. They were fewer infant deaths. Mm. So statistically, it always looked like people are living longer, but it was because the earlier data was horribly skewed by newborns, infants and babies dying, as they had historically. Now it seems like we've shifted it. So people in middle and later age can expect to live to a certain level, but that no one's breaking any records. No one's getting to 120, 130. All the gains are being made by people who may have historically died in their 60s, making it into their mid-80s, which is interesting. And, you know, it goes to our cost of living conversation as well. Society wasn't built to handle the majority of people living into their 80s and 90s.
No, well, that was the issue that China and Japan faced with their ageing population. Mm. So we did a lot of work on that at school in social geography, why they brought in the one-child policy, because they needed to work out a way not to curb as many people. Not the population wasn't the issue, but there weren't enough people to actually take care of the ageing population.
Problem that we're going to be grappling with here sooner rather than later if we're not already. As many as 14 million Americans are under flood alerts after a summer's worth of rain fell in parts of New York and Pennsylvania. Authorities are calling this a 1,000-year event after 3 months' worth of rain bucketed down across America's northeast. At least one person has been killed in fast-moving floodwaters in New York State, where dozens of vehicles were being washed away. A state emergency is in place.
Weather today, I already mentioned that those lucky enough to live in Darwin's currently 24 degrees. Those in Canberra, it's risen a bit. It's minus 0.1 instead of minus 0.6.
It's getting worse.
In the last 20 minutes. 17 today, mostly sunny. 17 tomorrow, also sunny. 17 again on Thursday and Friday before it dropping back down on Saturday to 14 degrees and showers if you're off to the football. And Sunday, 15 degrees, partly cloudy. A couple of texts here on the Dutton's text line. Sue in Christie's Beach says, I grew up in McGill. The planners were very inventive. First Street, Second Street, Third Street. And my home for the first 16 years was Fourth Street. Well, Sue, I reckon the planners in McGill also then went to St. Peter's and came up with First Avenue, Second Avenue, Third Avenue, etc. Anne says, I live in Oak Avenue in Marion, near Marion. There's also Ash, Birch and Gum. Mm. So there are real themes to these suburbs. I like that. Tree names. I don't mind that. Rosalie's called in. Good morning to you, Rosalie.
Hi, how are you?
Very well, thank you.
Good. Will was mentioning streets around the western suburbs named
after ships.
Ships and so on, mm. Yeah. Well, that was actually Fulham and
Fulham.
South Henry. Yes.
You are absolutely right.
The theme was the Battle of the Coral Sea.
Because there's Coral Sea Road there, isn't there?
Yes, yes. And so streets were named after commanders and all different types of battleships. So we had Admiral Halsey, Fletcher.
The Lexington, I think, was an aircraft carrier that the US had. I think there's a Lexington Street there.
Absolutely correct, yes. So Fletcher, Fitzroy, Kincaid, Place, Halsey were all commanders, Lexington, Yorktown, Portland. Yeah.
So, look, Rosalie, do you know why they set it on devoting an area of street names to the Battle of the Coral Sea?
Well, the area was originally built by the SA Housing Trust, our wool service homes and just general spec homes for people to purchase. So, for example, my father came to the city back in 1958 and bought a house on Halsey Road. So I think it was a tribute to the war effort. There's also an area in Elizabeth that did exactly the same. So they have very similar names up in Elizabeth as well, once again built by the Housing Trust. The unsung heroes were the Coast Watchers, mm. and on Coral Sea Road there's a Coast Watcher Park. And back on the 50th anniversary, I organised a great big tribute to the Battle of the Coral Sea.
Rosalie, that is just superb history. Thank you for calling in with that. We really appreciate it.
Rosalie, we're going to send you a $100 Uggs to You voucher.
Yeah, I think
that was
so.
Exceptional. We've got our new Henley Beach
How good is the 5AA audience?
I have Fulham Gardens history
correspondent. A random 605 thought bubble about a cluster of streets in the western suburbs, and Rosalie can tell us the entire potted history of it.
Congratulations, Rosemary. You can duck into UGG Studio on the corner of Grange and Frederick Road in Seaton. Let's turn our attention to sport. We will take more history calls after the break, though. We love to hear our local historians. Tom Rain is in the studio. Get 10-year warranty, 10 years cap price servicing on the new Mitsubishi Outlander at Agostino Mitsubishi. Morning, Tommy.
Morning, Lucy. Morning, Will. Just a little bit of history. We'll go to cricket, though. Maybe Will. Lucy, I know you're very good on your tennis. Will, maybe a bit more on the cricket.
I'll happily stay out of the cricket.
Last time we played without a recognised spinner, Australia.
Well, Nathan Lyon played almost 100 tests in a row. So we're going back a long way.
You've done well. It's 118 tests.
Okay.
So there's a lot of talk that the Aussies might go without a recognised spinner for the next test. Put your selection hat on. We're a week out from the fourth test. There's a lot of debate going on social media, as you can imagine. What do the Aussies do with Cam Green likely available?
Mm.
Mitch Marsh, you can't drop him, surely. I mean, he's just made 100 in a test match that was a low scorer and looked one of the more damaging bowlers as well. What happens? Do you drop Warner and put Travis Head to open? Do you drop Murphy and bring in Cameron Green and Mitch Marsh? What are you doing?
I don't like having... No spinner.
Yeah.
And I actually thought the way Pat Cummins used Todd Murphy was ridiculous in that second innings.
Mm-hmm.
What, did he bowl two overs? Yep. And he got one right at the death when it was pointless. The real problem with that strategy is we don't have any exposed form on which to assess him.
Yep. He bowled nine overs for the match.
If you're not going to bowl him, don't play him then.
Yep.
So I guess it's a conversation. You need to work out what Pat Cummins' thoughts are. I'd like to play him because I'd bowl him.
Yeah, and that's it. He needs to be given some time, doesn't he? And it looks like the conditions are going to be more favourable in Manchester. So I think he probably does have to play.
Mm.
But it's a big call. And do you bite the bullet with Dave Warner, or is it too far gone now? Because then if you throw Head up there or Mitch Marsh, you know, you're stuffing them around. So huge calls.
I'm inclined to trust Travis Head.
Yeah, let him go at the top of the order.
Put him at the top of the order.
Yep.
I just have total belief in his talent.
Yep.
And he's proven he's making runs over there.
Yeah, he's going pretty well so far. He's averaging close to 50 for the series, which is great going. Wimbledon, Lucy, we're getting to the pointy end. I know you're excited, probably a little bit bleary-eyed most mornings. Some big results overnight as well. Stefanos Tsitsipas lost to Chris Eubanks.
Huge.
Which was a big result there. That's the biggest one, I think, from overnight in terms of upsets. Carlos Alcaraz looked in trouble this morning as well.
I like Berrettini. I nearly wish he got up because I think he has the experience and he deserves to have a good game and a good win on grass. But Carlos Alcaraz is the young gun he's nearly unstoppable. Nearly.
I was talking to someone who knows their tennis very well and thinks that Alcaraz could, in 15 years, overtake Novak Djokovic. It's a big call.
Djokovic is theoretically set to win his 24th Grand Slam.
Yeah.
And this person thinks Alcaraz can beat that.
Thinks he'll dominate the circuit.
In 15 years. So he's got to win one and a half Grand Slams a year.
Yeah. Big call.
That is a massive call.
If he's still healthy enough to do it in that time.
Well, this is the thing. So, and I guess the problem is you don't know what other tennis talent's going to come through. Is there going to be another generational talent, or is he going to have it all? Look, I think we all suspect he's going to be very good and will win multiple slams. He's got one. He won a US Open already, but...
He's 20. He was born in 2003. He's already won one. Theoretically, by this age, he ought to have won two or three then, do we think, to be better than Novak?
Yeah, I think Novak won his first in 2008. So what was that, 15 years ago? He would have been probably about the similar age. He would have been 20. Mm. He's, I think, 35 now. Maybe 36?
He's 36.
So he was 21. So, you know.
Okay.
But it's pretty fast pace. And then the body needs to be fit, all of that as well.
Actually, you're right. Sorry, Novak won. His first major title was the 2008 Australian Open at the age of 20.
Yeah.
So, right. So he's on track.
He's on track, but he's got to get a wriggle on.
I love some of the little quirky stories that pop up during these major tournaments. I watched a bit of the Madison Keys Andreeva game.
Yes.
The young Russian girl, 16 years of age.
Yep.
Never played on grass before turning up to qualify for Wimbledon.
It's amazing, isn't it?
She looks like an absolute powerhouse.
And it sort of, continues this theory of the Eastern European bloc just producing these amazing tennis talents that come through. So that has been one of the big stories as well. So looking forward, no Australians left, unfortunately, in the singles draw.
I'm so disappointed with the Australians' performance this year.
Mm.
but...
Yeah, hopefully next year. But I think we've got still a little bit of Max Purcell in the doubles with Jordan Thompson. So hopefully they can do something. Alex de Minaur lost with Katie Poulter, the sort of new power couple of tennis, if you like.
Yeah, maybe goes to show don't play with your partner.
Yeah, yeah, exactly right.
I'm bitter about it, but
don't
I will
mix
be.
Business and pleasure, perhaps, right. You know. So anyway, that's it for the tennis. We'll keep a close eye on that over the coming days.
Thank you, Tommy. We'll hear your sport update tomorrow morning. Up next, we'll take some more of your calls after the news with Kendall.
Take a look outside. It's hardly board shorts and mojitos weather. But at Adelaide Outdoor Kitchens, we're taking orders right now for summer. There's still time to lock in a consultation about your outdoor entertaining needs, from a custom concrete bench to a full outdoor kitchen with appliances. And we'll have your Adelaide Outdoor Kitchen ready before mojitos are back on the menu. But time is limited. Go to adelaideoutdoorkitchens.com.au today.
Amongst the euphoria and upheaval of the late 60s, the Beatles released a masterpiece, The White Album. Chris Cheney, Phil Jamieson, Josh Pike and Tim Rogers join 17 musicians to perform it live. The White Album concert, one more time. Festival Theatre, Friday, September 8th. Book now at Ticketek.
Fancy a wine? You'll find a huge hand-picked selection at your local independent SA family liquor store, Fascina. Or if you fancy a beer, you'll find the very best local, imported and craft beer at Fascina too. But if you fancy spirits, you'll find whiskies, gins and liquors for all tastes at Fascina. And you'll find friendly service and advice too. Whatever you fancy, you'll find it at Fascina, your local independent SA family liquor stores for over 45 years. 5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube.
This is Adelaide's 5AA.
Mostly sunny and 17 with the 6:30 news. I'm Kendall Brantig.
Woken with a stiff neck or sore back? Get a Physio Extra appointment today. Six locations. Physioextra.com.
An Australian surveillance aircraft will be deployed to Germany to assist military and humanitarian efforts in Ukraine. Up to 100 Australian defence personnel will spend 6 months on deployment with the Wedgetail early warning aircraft. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese says Australia's a long way from Europe, but it's important the democratic world reacts to Russia's disregard for rules-based order.
One of the things that this war has done is remind us that in today's interconnected, globalised world, an event such as the land war in Europe has an impact on the entire world.
While Australia will join the US, UK and European countries in signing on to Germany's elite climate club, the move could help us avoid EU sanctions on nations that aren't considered to be doing their fair share when it comes to reducing emissions. The federal government says it'll be able to help shape the goals of the fledgling group, which was only founded late last year. The husband and father of two SA women killed in the Hunter Valley bus crash has choked back tears while laying them to rest. Nadine and Kaya were both killed in last month's tragedy. Graham McBride lit a candle for his wife and daughter and thanked the first responders who helped pull survivors from the bus. Households are looking at winding back spending on travel, gyms, cafes and entertainment as cost of living pressures take a toll. The Commonwealth Bank Household Spending Intentions Index fell 1.7% in June as consumer activity weakened across a range of categories. While a growing number of young Australians are choosing insecure work over study. More from Emily Minnie.
There's concerns the pandemic, rising cost of living and caring responsibilities are hampering students' long-term career opportunities. The Smith Family's Pathway Engagement and Transitions Longitudinal Survey found while 57% of respondents were engaged with employment or study in 2022, many were working jobs with unclear career progression opportunities. 14% were working at least two jobs, 37% were wanting to work more hours, while 34% were looking for a new job. Fewer than half those surveyed were studying, and some had been forced to drop out due to financial, health, and online learning challenges.
The average lifespan in Australia has increased by 12 months every 4 years since the start of the 20th century. A new report by the Australian Institute of Health and Welfare shows improved medical knowledge, healthcare and living conditions are the key contributors. The Institute's Richard Ukes says more people are living longer, but the maximum age has barely moved.
So less and less Australians are dying at younger ages, and more Australians are reaching ages 80, 90 or 100. It's just that we're not getting much beyond that.
Rain has bucketed down across northeastern areas of America. New York State has declared a state of emergency following intense flash flooding. At least one person has died. And a US couple who survived a deadly volcanic eruption in New Zealand have been the first to testify in the trial of tourism operators. Six companies and directors have been charged over health and safety issues. The White Island volcano erupted in 2019, killing 22 people. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Get 10-year warranty and 10 years capped price servicing on the new Mitsubishi Outlander at Agostino Mitsubishi.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Adelaide insists it's working hard to arrest its poor away form, which has seen the club win only one match away from Adelaide Oval this season. The Crows have won only one of seven matches on the road, the latest loss coming against Essendon at Marvel Stadium on Sunday. Defender Lockie Scholl telling Rowie and Timmy G they know it's become an issue.
We're trying different things and we're obviously aware of our away record and, we're certainly trying to rectify that.
The Bombers, meantime, are weighing up an appeal against the one-game ban handed to Andrew Phillips for rough conduct. Phillips was suspended for bumping Adelaide's Riley O'Brien in the head whilst attempting a shepherd. It leaves the Bombers without both of their first-choice ruckmen for Saturday's away clash with the Cats. Let's go to tennis. Little-known American Christopher Eubanks is capturing the hearts of fans at Wimbledon, upsetting heavyweight Stefanos Tsitsipas in five sets to reach the quarterfinals. The world number 43 says it's been a surreal run to the quarters.
The entire experience altogether has just been a whirlwind, and it's been, you know, something that you dream about. But I think for me, I didn't really know if that dream would actually come true, and I'm sitting here in it now, so it's pretty cool.
Elsewhere, Carlos Alcaraz, Holger Rune and Novak Djokovic are all through to the men's final eight. And tomorrow's third and final Origin game to be played at Olympic Park in Sydney will see Queensland's Harry Grant make his second on-field Origin appearance. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now the 5AA forecast.
Pack away the boardies and bikinis, pull out the uggies and get your brakes checked at Automasters.
Mostly sunny and 17 today, more of the same on Wednesday and Thursday, tops of 17, and then partly cloudy for Friday, 17 again. At the moment, 12. More news as it happens on 5AA.
5AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
Test drive the Cherry Emoda 5 at Cherry Glen Osmond from 33K Drive Away with immediate delivery. Go Cherry.
6:36. Good morning to you on this Tuesday morning. Just before 7 o'clock, we are chatting with Claire Shuttleworth from the Port Adelaide National Trust, which has sparked quite an incredibly historically based conversation amongst our listeners. And I'm so impressed for this time of the morning about street names in suburbs around Adelaide. A couple of comments here on the Foodland Supermarket's Facebook live stream. I referenced Alexander Hill having a street in the Riverland where he's from because he's an Olympic rower. Well, Greg has commented on the Facebook stream. Greg from Loxton here. We have Sophie Eddington Drive. She's a swimmer. Grant Schubert Drive from hockey. Alexander Hill Drive from rowing. And Serena Parker, who is a Paralympics tandem cycling. And that's she's got a walking trail named after her. So if you go to the Riverland, you're going to be driving and walking along places named after Olympians.
Celebrating great Australian athletes. If you are in the area in Clapham, it'll feel like going through parts of Canada. Kelly from Clapham says, we've got a lot of streets named after places in Canada. Toronto, Quebec, Columbia, Windermere, Ottawa, Vancouver, and in Clarence Gardens is a group of streets named after rivers. Avon, Esk, Mersey, Derwent, Tweed, Severn and Tamar. Thank you for that, Kelly. Peter and Elizabeth Parker's called into the program. Morning to you, Peter.
Good morning, Will. In Elizabeth Park, we've got Midway, Yorktown, Halsey, all reminiscent of World War II.
Naval battles as well. So
yep.
Are yours there inspired by the Battle of Midway as opposed to the Coral Sea, or is it just a whole host of naval references?
Well, Yorktown was an aircraft carrier.
Yep.
Halsey was the leader of the fight at Midway. And that's about it. I know it was Second World War, and that's about it.
Turning point in the battle in the Pacific, the battle Midway.
Yeah,
absolutely. Peter, thank you for that. I wonder. I'm just trying to think what other great naval confrontations we might have that have inspired entire streets and suburbs in South Australia. Sally in Hillcrest has called in. Morning, Sally.
Good morning. How are you?
Good, Sal.
I grew up at Parra Hills West, and our last name was Field. There were three other Fields within a street away, but the streets around us are Goodfield, B Field, A Field, and C Field.
No.
Yeah.
The originality there is incredible. Thank you, Sally. What'd she say? A Field, B Field, C Field. Amazing.
Yeah, well, that is extraordinary. Keep them coming in. We'll get to the bottom of why every street is called what it is in Adelaide at this rate. 8223 000, the number you can text us on that Dutton's text line. Have you ever been swimming at Wongai Falls? It's a lagoon, essentially, in Litchfield National Park, which is not Kakadu. It's much closer to Darwin. Magnificent national park, about an hour south. We were there just over a year ago, swam at Wongai Falls, and did so well before a story yesterday that would have meant I was zero chance of jumping in that water, because a 2-metre-long crocodile has been confirmed as responsible for mauling a man in his 60s. There were 80 people swimming in this lagoon, children as well. A local a police officer that was on leave there managed to help organise people into a circle. Could you imagine the terror of this? You get in a circle to make sure you're all sort of together and try to exit the water together, knowing that there's this giant crocodile hunting people in there, small children in there. Have a listen to what some of the witnesses had to say.
In the water.
We heard some sirens coming, and we saw paramedics, and then we learnt that someone had an interaction with a crocodile in the Wangi Falls area.
He seems smallish in size, but probably 2 metres long, but slender, you know. So he was only just had his back out of the water slightly, so you really couldn't see the whole croc.
They spoke to ABC News. They're in the Northern Territory. What's the theory behind the collective exodus? Like when you join in a circle, is that so there's...
I think just a large group of people and it might think twice. I don't think anyone's read there's no textbook about how to evade an angry crocodile.
Is it so no one's left vulnerable? Like someone's kicking out with one leg and it might go for the one person, but if there's all 80 of you...
I presume children were probably in the middle of that circle as well, so they were sort of protected by the adults there. What a terrifying scene, though. There are signs everywhere in Litchfield and Kakadu, and I'd love to hear from listeners who've swam at Wongai Falls before, or in some of those lagoons around the area, because you are always uneasy. The water is that certain colour that just says there could be something lurking beneath here. And there are signs everywhere saying, beware, crocodiles live in this area. Now, we went on a tour in Litchfield into this area that was roped off and had been very recently fenced off. And again, I won't do this in a million years now, having heard this story. But the guide we were with said, oh, don't. Very Northern Territory. Don't worry. The one that was hanging around in here, we got rid of him. And this is all just needs to be pulled down 2 weeks ago. So he sort of lowered all the temporary fencing so everyone could go. And we went and swam in the area that had been fenced off because it had a giant crocodile in there.
And you trusted him, Will?
I trusted him. I will not trust again, Luce. People, if you've swum in any of these places and lagoons in the Northern Territory, want to hear from you this morning. And certainly this one is one of the most popular. I bet we've got people who either did swim or thought twice about it and just went and looked at the magnificent waterfalls, because it's a beautiful part of Australia too.
They make note that the crocodile itself was not that big. It was a slender-looking creature, but 2 metres in length. So, I mean...
Not that big.
In my mind.
You describe it as not that big if you weren't the one in the water with it.
Yeah, it's... Like, I'm only 5'2". That thing is a lot bigger than I am.
No, thanks. Not interested.
I am 3/4 of its size.
Yeah.
No. In context, for anyone who's ever stood next to me, just picture a tiny crocodile that's 2 metres in length. Yeah, not so tiny, is it? Text us if you have been to the Northern Territory or swum in the falls or, you know, come out of a croc encounter, similar type thing. The Dutton's text line 0448 08 1395. Volkswagen Tiguan Allspace, the seven-seater that's perfect for weekends away, camping trips and the crazy Saturday sports rush. Coming up shortly, we will chat more about Port Adelaide's Heritage Trust and the heritage buildings they're trying to save. But first, let's check your traffic.
Thanks, Anne. Good morning. Got a two-car collision today. Grand Junction Road at Enfield. It's just near Main North Road. A few burst waterway to keep your eye out for two. Got one at the Adelaide Airport, so Donald Rabbit Drive just opposite the golf club. Speeds in out of 40. Another burst waterway at Erbrae, Glen Osmond Road at the bottom of the freeway. Freeway up track is slow at the moment. Some got cameras Addison Road, Pennington, and Bevington Road at Glenunka. Choosing Bradford Homes by Scott Salisbury is a wise choice. You can count on their experience and reputation to guide you every step of the way. Visit bradfordhomes.com.au. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
New Zealand. Spectacular, safe and friendly. The perfect destination for a magical getaway. Right now, Holiday Wonders Mitcham have an exclusive 17-day fully inclusive package. It's our best deal ever. Save up to $980 per couple. Fly direct from Adelaide with Air New Zealand, touring North and South Islands with meals, accommodation and so much included, with more highlights than any comparable New Zealand holiday. Call now or visit holidaywonders.com.au. Holiday Wonders, Belair Road, Mitcham.
If you thought it was tricky to source a great deal on a new Volkswagen, think again. Mawson Lakes Volkswagen's demo clearance is on now. We've loaded up on a massive range of demo Volkswagens available for delivery right now. Loads of colours, loads of options, plus on-site finance options available. And remember, we offer next day servicing too. So hurry, the Volkswagen demo clearance won't last. Mawson Lakes Volkswagen, Salisbury Highway, just a short drive from the city.
This month, all kids 14 and under get to go to the footy for free.
What about that?
That's all games between rounds 16 and 19 of the 2023 Toyota AFL Premiership season. From selfies to screamers and tasty treats.
Spectacular!
Make it an awesome day for the family with a day out at the footy. Kids go free rounds 16 to 19.
Boy, oh boy, wow, wee!
Go to afl.com.au/kidsmonth. Terms and conditions apply. Subject to capacity and availability.
Hey, excuse me, you're Adam, right?
Yeah, I'm Adam.
The Adam who bought his hearing aids at Specsavers?
Actually, yeah.
The Adam who got quoted thousands more elsewhere, then got top-of-the-range hearing aids at Specsavers?
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, everyone, this is Adam. Yeah.
Get your hearing aids at Specsavers and you'll never hear the end of it. We've got everyday low prices on the latest tech hearing aids. Book your free 15-minute hearing check with your local audiology professional at specsavers.com.au/hearing. Conditions apply.
Hi, Bronte Manuel from Toop and Toop. Now more than ever, you need an agent who's not just out for a quick sale. You need someone who can stand their ground to ensure you're maximising your home's potential. There's a good reason Toop and Toop is defying market trends and continuing to deliver premium outcomes for its clients. With a history spanning almost 40 years and a team of unrivaled experience, Toop and Toop knows what it takes to maximise your results in any selling conditions. Visit toop.com.au to find out more.
5AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
The Cherry Emoda 5, state-of-the-art driving from 33K drive away with immediate delivery. Visit Cherry Glen Osmond.
A big hello to Bill and Catherine. They are watching us from Scotland. They're on holiday Linlithgow. While they're on holiday in Scotland, they say it's a Scottish summer, rain and more rain, but it is beautiful. Telling us more about our local weather here, though, is Jenny Horvat. Good morning to you, Jenny.
Good morning, Lucy. Good morning, Will.
So 17 and sunny today. That's quite a treat for July.
Yes, it is. Yeah, no rain in sight for the next couple of days. Actually, a little bit of a cloudy start this morning, but we should see some sunny breaks coming through. We did see our minimum temperature of 10.9 degrees. That happened around 2 a.m. this morning. Currently 11.7 at our West Terrace Night Appear Observation Site. As you mentioned, Lucy, we are looking at top temperature in the city of around 17 degrees. Likewise for Elizabeth, 16 for Glenelg and Noarlunga. Mount Barker aiming for 15 degrees. Sunny conditions for Wednesday, a little bit cooler start though, maybe a minimum of around 8 degrees. But again, we're looking at maximum temperature of 17 degrees. Similar conditions for Thursday, maybe a little bit of cloud coming through, but mostly sunny nevertheless. Again, around 17 degrees on Thursday after a minimum temperature of 8. On Friday, we should be pretty dry again, aiming for 17 degrees. We've got this change that's been on the horizon. It looks like it's going to come through a little bit slower. So I'm thinking Friday should be a dry day as well, with those showers either developing late Friday or Saturday. So possibly a shower or two around on the Saturday there. But following that change, that temperature coming back down to around 14 degrees. 15 for Sunday, not too much shower activity left by then. And again, 15 degrees to start next week.
Wonderful. Thank you so much there, Jenny Horvat at the Bureau of Meteorology. Let's get to our SAPOL Cross of the Morning. Senior Constable Rebecca Stokes is on duty. Morning to you, Beck.
Good morning.
And our truck has lost its load at Port Wakefield Road this morning.
Yeah, this one's a bit yucky, so apologies if you're having brekkie right now. Roads have reopened after a truck lost part of its load, causing an obstruction at Paralowie this morning. It happened just before 2 a.m. Police were called to Port Wakefield Road and Bolivar Road after reports a truck had spilt part of its load. And when they arrived, they observed a large pile of chicken carcasses blocking one of the lanes, causing the road to become very slippery and greasy.
Oh, no.
Yeah. And luckily, it wasn't, you know, peak summer, so we've got that going for us. But lucky it's not, you know, smell a radio. It appears that the driver carrying the chickens had to brake heavily at the lights, causing the carcasses to be flung from the trailer. Unfortunately, there were no reported injuries. Road transport crews have been out there for several hours working to clear the scene, and apparently they were happily assisted by local foxes. Traffic restrictions were in place, but yeah, they've worked really hard and the clean-up's just been completed, and Port Wakefield Road has just reopened with no restrictions for peak hour.
Beck, whose job did you say was to clean that up? Like, who gets a phone call at 2 o'clock in the morning to say, can you come clean up some chicken carcasses off a major highway?
Exactly. The Department of Road Transport, and they've done an excellent job there. That would not be fun work. So, yeah, hats off to them this morning.
So no more traffic hold-ups from now?
No, that should be all clear. So, yeah, I can imagine that would have been a mess to clean up.
Thank you, Beck. That's just made
Thank
my
you.
Morning. Senior Constable Rebecca Stokes. Chicken carcasses across Port Wakefield Road this morning at 2 a.m.
I saw that story earlier in the morning when I first got up. The nondescript way the government department reported it was a truck has lost its load and there are traffic delays in the area. My God, it sounds like a scene from a horror film.
Oh, that just
good day
made,
to be a fox, though.
I love that Beck pops that in there, that foxes no doubt would have been all over that. We talked a lot about suburban streets this morning. I've seen a lot of foxes in our suburbs. Driving to work that early, I see a lot of them going from garden to garden.
Mm.
And I don't know if it is because it's 3 o'clock in the morning or 4 o'clock or five, whatever it is, but I find they're coming less and less out of parklands. I see them more coming out of people's gardens rather than coming from, say, the Linear Park Trail up in my area. I see them more coming out of houses.
Mm, eating scraps and disrupting chicken coops. We've got a few near us.
Yeah, heading up to Bolivar at 2 o'clock this morning to feast on some chicken carcasses. Anyway, if you are eating your breakfast this morning, we'll leave the chicken discussion right there. We will get to our topic of the first hour, which has been heritage buildings. What is something special in your area that is heritage listed, a national treasure, a South Australian treasure? And to join us this morning is Claire Shuttleworth from the Port Adelaide National Trust. Good morning to you, Claire.
Good morning, Lucy and Will.
Now, you are making a bid to save the iconic sailing club down there at Port Adelaide. It's supposedly been acquired by Cedar Woods, who, of course, developed the Glenside area, but you guys want to save the sailing club, of course.
I guess you know the site. It's been there for quite a while, and really it's not just the building itself. It's just the things that have happened around there. It's really been the start of a whole lot of aquatic recreation and sporting events in the port, and it's really, if this goes, there's not much left in the inner port that reminds us of what's been.
So how big an area is the area that you want to have cordoned off and safe from development, Claire?
Well, we're really just talking about the building.
The building
itself.
So if
you go over Birkenhead Bridge, but around that, there's currently a community garden, and there's some, you know, it comes down onto the river, so there's the, and the Dragon Boat Club have used it, so there's access to the river and some pontoons and that sort of thing.
So, Claire, for the area to be considered as a heritage-listed building, how does that happen? I understand it has to be nominated, the site itself, by a member from the public?
Well, we've nominated it, and so it's gone to the SA, the Heritage Council, and they then do an assessment based on their criteria for what's significant, and they're meeting on August 17th to make a decision on whether they'll provisionally list the building.
Tell us a bit about the history of the building, Claire. You mentioned it's significant in terms of the early days of water activity at the port. Anything in specific that comes to mind?
Well, I guess in 1838, the first regatta was held on the river and out the front of there. That the building itself wasn't there then. It's been moved. Like lots of, you know, sort of buildings of its time, it's had lots of changes and comings and goings. And I guess the really interesting thing about this building has been that it's not your regular sailing club. It's been a working man's sailing club. A lot of the early people who sailed from there also lived and worked in the port. They built their own boats, often on the slips that were next door. And the building's really, you know, changed and adapted according to what's been going on. It seems to us that we've been talking about it a bit as ground zero for recreational sporting activity in the water around the port. And, you know, it's not been used for that since early 2000s when there was going to be a development that was going to pull that down then. So the sailing club moved. However, since then, it's been the home of both, as I said, the Dragon Boat Club and also the Port Adelaide Arts Forum, and they've kept the place going with both sporting activities, cultural activities, exhibitions. It's the space has been rented out. I've been to, you know, weddings, funerals and parties there. So it's had a bit of an interesting history, but as I say, we are losing that whole working history of the port.
So August 17 is the next, I guess, milestone in a bid to save it.
That's right, yes.
August 17. Thank you for your time this morning, Claire. Claire Shuttleworth there from the Port Adelaide National Trust. We'd love to find out what happens on August 17th, because once, if the building does get approved to be listed as State Heritage, then Cedar Woods, as developers, will need to reassess their plans.
It's led to a really fascinating conversation this morning about the origins of street names and some of the heritage-listed things in your suburb around Adelaide. Lots of Dutton's ticks coming through. Lyndon says, Camden Park, nearly all the street names start with C. Creslin, Cromer, Kappa, Carlton, Carlisle, Collin and Curzon are just a few of those. I wasn't aware of this. Tony says, Salisbury East is a pocket of streets named after cricketers. Harvey, Simpson, Benno.
Imagine living on Benno Road.
It's just superb. People would have no trouble. You know, to remember people's street names or addresses and things. So if you're a 4th Street, good luck. I'm not going to remember it. But if you live on Benno Street or Benno Road or Avenue, that's fantastic. No one's ever going to... No, 22, Sam Dado just said. Choo-choo, Benno Street. That would be the most memorable. That might be Adelaide's most memorable address.
If you do reside on Benno Street, please give us a ring. Yeah, if you live in number 22, even better.
You're exactly right.
We'll dig up something extremely memorable for you to be that caller. Hannah from Moffat Vale says, my mother and father-in-law's house in Sturt is heritage listed. They've lived there for about 50 years.
Beautiful. Linda's called in from Hallett Cove. Morning to you, Linda.
Good morning, Will and Lucy.
Hello, Linda.
Just something that happened yesterday. My daughter and husband and two teenage grandsons flew to Cairns for a holiday, 5-day holiday.
Beautiful.
And the flight was an hour and a half late taking off. But when they got there, I've never heard of this before, but only 13 pieces of luggage arrived.
What?
The rest was left in Adelaide.
It was a full flight, Linda, yeah. I'm assuming, up to Cairns, which is, what, 200 people, let's say, and only 13 pieces of luggage made it up there.
Yep.
So they were running an hour and a half late, and they didn't even have time in that extra hour and a half to pack the plane with people's luggage.
I just found it bizarre.
Can we ask what airline they flew, Linda?
You can. It was Jetstar. Mm. They're flying home with Virgin. But
What's happening to their luggage?
It apparently is going to arrive today, but, you know, that's a lot of luggage to put on another flight.
You know, I find it sad, Linda. The state of airlines in this country, it's both sad for Australian travellers, but it's particularly embarrassing, I think, when we sell ourselves as a nation as a tourism destination. And this kind of stuff goes on all the time. It goes on to the point now people talk about, well, it's commonplace. No one bats an eyelid when their plane's running an hour and a half late. It's just, well, that's just what it's like travelling in Australia now. You can people buy air tags with the expectation your luggage is going to go to a random location. This is Australia.
Cairns is not difficult to get to.
Cairns is
one flight. One flight. Linda, please let us know what happens when your family flies home. We'd love to get an update of, well, if they get their luggage today, if the rest of the flight gets their luggage, let us know when they're due to fly back. We'd love to hear an update.
I won't go into it. I tweeted about it. I had our own troubles travelling back on our holidays just recently. But the thing that really underscored how ridiculous this whole situation to me was when I was at the desk making a complaint and the person next to me had just gotten off a plane from Canada. They'd chosen to spend thousands of dollars coming to Australia and they had been then subjected to the Australian airline industry and a flight had been changed and no one could help them. And this poor girl travelling by herself, her first impression of Australia was a really unhelpful person working at an airline help desk, in inverted commas, and dealing with an airline system that was once the envy of the world and now I think it's a national embarrassment. I wish Linda's story was one that was surprising.
If you'd like to read more about Will's journey coming back from Fiji, please jump on his Twitter at W Goodings. Coming up after the 7 o'clock news with Kendall, we'll jump into a few of the overnight stories and speak with Olivia Savis, the local member for Newland.
Adelaide Direct Stationers is more than just stationery. We're one of SA's largest suppliers of tech products, washroom products, PPE, workplace health and safety equipment, office furniture, food, snacks, beverages and much more. We have all your office and business needs in one place. With free next day delivery on orders over $50, plus same day 2-hour express delivery. Adelaide Direct Stationers, serving SA's largest businesses and a preferred government supplier. Visit adelaidedirectstationers.com.au.
When it comes to talking retirement, parents will change the subject to anything. And I mean anything. There's things you just can't unhear. So save yourself the overshares. Talk to them about rentirement at Warner Close, Murray Bridge instead. With no messy contracts and no hidden fees, your parents can get all the perks of retirement and the support they need without giving up their freedom. Have the rentirement talk with your parents. Visit warnerclose.com.au. SA Community Owned.
Footprints, hundreds of them, thin ones, big ones, muddy ones, in every room of your house. You might expect that from tradies when you're renovating, but not when you choose Bathrooms by Design. All our tradies, including tilers, plumbers, electricians and carpenters, are overseen by one project manager. They're flawless, meticulous and as coordinated as a ballet, but without the tutus. Reward yourself every day with a luxury bathroom. View our designs at bathroomsbydesign.com.au.
5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube.
Online, on DAB Digital Radio and on 1395 AM. Talking Adelaide. This is Adelaide's 5AA.
Mostly sunny and 17 with the 7 o'clock news. I'm Kendall Brettie.
Looking for the perfect winter exercise? Physio Extra offers clinical Pilates at 6 locations. PhysioExtra.com.
A mess to clean up on Port Wakefield Road at Paralowie this morning. Senior Constable Rebecca Stokes says a truck lost its load of chicken carcasses.
The driver carrying the chickens had to brake heavily at the lights, causing the carcasses to be flung from the trailer. Unfortunately, there were no reported injuries. A road transport crews have been out there for several hours working to clear the scene, and apparently they were happily assisted by local foxes.
And road restrictions have now been lifted. Egg prices may go as high as $15 a carton if a push to phase out caged eggs by 2036 is adopted. Federal and state ministers will this week discuss bringing forward an end to caged chicken eggs by 10 years. National Senator Bridget McKenzie says it'll have a flow-on effect.
We'll drive up the cost not only of eggs, but of food right through the supply chain because we use eggs in so many everyday goods. We eat 17 million of them every single day.
The Prime Minister has announced Australia will join the US, UK and European countries in signing on to Germany's elite climate club. It could help us avoid sanctions from the EU on countries it believes aren't doing their fair share to reduce emissions. Anthony Albanese is hoping Australia's membership will help shape the club's role in a way that complements our climate objectives. The PM says no challenge is more pressing than climate change.
Australia and Germany are now united in our deep commitment to tackling climate change. And I commended Chancellor Scholz on his development of Germany's Climate Club and was pleased to confirm that Australia will join that high ambition initiative.
An Australian surveillance aircraft will be based in Germany for the next 6 months to assist military and humanitarian efforts in Ukraine. Up to 100 Australian Defence Force personnel will also be deployed to Europe. Two of our regional hospitals are stepping up their security after several troubling incidents. More from David Bruce.
Around-the-clock security will be introduced at the Port Perry and Wallaroo hospitals after a number of code black incidents involving elderly patients. In one of those incidents, a patient punched a nurse in the head at the Port Perry hospital and then chased others around a ward. And a few months ago, a violent patient at the Wallaroo hospital had to be tasered by police to bring them under control. Security guards will be employed 24/7 and staff have been offered training on how to deal with such situations. There's already around-the-clock security at the Mount Gambier and Port Lincoln hospitals.
Former US gymnastics doctor Larry Nassar has been stabbed multiple times in prison. Nassar is serving up to 175 years for sexually abusing women and girls over a 20-year period. He was stabbed 10 times in the neck, back and chest. And as many as 14 million Americans are under flood alerts as a year's worth of rain fell in parts of New York and Pennsylvania. More from US correspondent Lauren Tomasi.
Authorities are calling this a 1-in-1,000-year event. 3 months of rain bucketing down across America's northeast. At least one person has been killed in fast-moving floodwaters in New York State, where dozens of vehicles are being washed away. A state of emergency now in place.
Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Get 10-year warranty and 10 years capped price servicing on the new Mitsubishi Outlander at Agostino Mitsubishi.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide captain Tom Jonas is firming to return for Saturday's Twilight Clash against Carlton at Marvel Stadium. Jonas hasn't played since round 10, but is set to come in for the injured Trent McKenzie. And assistant coach Nathan Bassett has told Rowie and Timmy G they're expecting Jonas to perform well.
TJ will lead. He'll bring some good energy into the team. And, we know he'll give his absolute best to whoever he plays on this week to beat them and contribute to the team winning.
McKenzie is set to miss at least 1 week, while the Powers ruckman Scott Lysett has a chance to come back in after missing the past fortnight with a knee injury. And Adelaide is set to celebrate Rory Sloane's 250th match this week as the club looks to bounce back against GWS at home on Saturday night. Let's go to cricket, and Australia's selectors face some major selection headaches ahead of the fourth Ashes test beginning in Manchester next week. The Aussies have to decide whether to play both Mitch Marsh and Cam Green, who look set to return from injury. Dave Warner, Todd Murphy and Scott Boland are all under pressure to retain their spots in the side. Ange Postecoglou will try to convince Tottenham captain Harry Kane to stay at the club amid interest from Bayern Munich when the striker returns for pre-season this week. Meantime, former Manchester United star Ashley Young is expected to sign with Everton. And in some basketball, the San Antonio Spurs will rest number one NBA draft pick Victor Wembanyama for the rest of the summer league. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now to the traffic.
Good morning. At Enfield, two-car collision on Grand Junction Road near Main North Road. Adelaide Airport, Burst Waterway and Sir Donald Bradman Drive, just opposite the golf club, speeds at 40. And Herbray, Burst Waterway near too. Glen Osmond Road at the bottom of the freeway. Starting to get busy, South Road at Edwardstown with cameras this morning, Days Road, Croydon Park and Toothy Street at Unley. In winter, nothing beats a hot sausage roll for lunch. At OTR, you can get two for just $6. Traditional, cheese and bacon and spinach and cheese. OTR. Making life easy. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Pack away the bikinis and boardies, pull out the woolies and get your brakes checked at Automasters.
Mostly sunny and 17 today. More of the same on Wednesday and Thursday. Tops of 17 and partly cloudy for Friday, also 17. At the moment, 12. More news as it happens on 5AA.
5AA Breakfast.
sunny and 17 today, so hopefully you can get out and about. Sunrise official time this morning, 7:23, but a beautiful sunrise is just popping up over Hindmarsh Square this morning. If you are in a spot where it's a beautiful sunrise, please text us your photos. We love to see them and we'll pop them up on the Foodland live stream, 0448 08 13 95.
If you see a fox with an entire Ingham's chicken carcass in its mouth too, call us and let us know. Bizarre.
That's my favourite story of the week.
Truck rollover situation. Port Wakefield Road, wasn't it?
Yeah, up at Paralowie and Bolivar. I hope the truck driver is fine. There were no reports of any injuries. The chickens were already deceased, I understand. It was a lot of carcasses.
Great morning for foxes. If you're in the area, though, I don't know if we want an actual eyewitness account, but I've got to confess, I'm sort of intrigued.
Yeah, it is all cleaned up now. There are no more traffic delays if you are on Port Wakefield Road. But if you happen to be out there in the early hours of this morning, please text us in a photo. I'm endlessly fascinated with this story, and Sam's moving me swiftly along. Yeah,
he's very squeamish.
So let's chat about our Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese.
Yeah, we'll start the news wrap of the morning in Germany. It's where the Prime Minister is and has been for the last day. It's a stopover on the way to Lithuania for the NATO summit that's set to take place there this week. And the Prime Minister's made a significant announcement. Yesterday, it was about the export, $1 billion export of armoured vehicles to Germany. Today, it's about support for Ukraine, with the ADF deploying now a Royal Australian Air Force E-7A Wedgetail to Germany for 6 months from October to help protect what they're calling a vital gateway of international humanitarian and military assistance to Ukraine. The deployment includes up to 100 crew and support personnel. So that's Australian Air Force personnel operating out of Germany to secure the supply lines to Ukraine. So not operating in Ukraine, operating in Germany to make sure that things that need to arrive in Ukraine do, and do so safely. And as the Prime Minister explained, it is a significant and symbolic contribution.
This contribution is very significant, both for what it will do, but also for what it symbolises as well, which is Australia's commitment to doing what we can to provide the appropriate resources which will maximise the impact of Australia's contribution to support for the integrity and borders and sovereignty of Ukraine.
We suspect the last of the German-based announcements before we, as part of the Indo-Pacific Four, attend by way of special invite the NATO summit later this week. Good news out of North America for Madonna fans. She suffered a serious bacterial infection that led to her being in ICU. So she was in a particularly bad way in intensive care. But by way of an Instagram post yesterday, she released some thoughts saying, "My first thought when I woke up in hospital was about my children. My second thought was that I did not want to disappoint anyone who had bought tickets for my tour. Also didn't want to let down the people who worked tirelessly with me over the last few months to create my show. I hate to disappoint anyone. My focus now is my health and getting stronger, and I assure you I'll be back with you as soon as I can." She says the international tour will kick off in October. So some good news, because when she was first put in the ICU, some of the reporting was pretty grim about her condition. Now, for her to be talking about being 3 months away from a world tour, fantastic news.
There were a few conspiracy theories floating around, though, that said the opposite. People thought they'd seen her the day before in cafes looking very sprightly, etc.
Oh, really?
And then they thought maybe she's just really run down. But I think there's been reports that she was inches away from death and she had to be brought back to life effectively with some kind of intravenous dose of something or other that would do such a thing, but it's great news that she has actually recovered.
We'll take the reporting at face value, Luce, but let's just to indulge the conspiracy for a moment. If you are one of the most famous people on earth, this is what pulling a sickie looks like, I guess.
Yeah.
It has to be dramatic to pull out of your world tour. You can't just call in with a headache and say, I'm not coming in for the next 6 months.
Another conspiracy theory was that the amount of plastic surgery she has had on her face of late has contributed to her illness.
Why do people do that to themselves?
It's all on Twitter. You can find whatever you like on Twitter and you can believe what you choose to believe.
90% of that plastic surgery stuff looks horrific.
Well, she's 64, but I can tell you she doesn't look 64. Let's put it that way. And our third local story of the morning involves State Member for Newland, Olivia Savvas MP. Morning, Liv.
Morning, Lou. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining us. You alerted me to a story last night, which I'm not sure many people would be aware of. We reported a few weeks ago that the Marion Westfield post office was shutting and probably has already shut, but now you are aware of another one that's closing.
Yeah, so a couple of months ago, about the time when Westfield Marion was set to close, the store at Tea Tree Plaza put up a notice saying that they would be closing on Saturdays. Now, I wrote to the Minister for Communications, Minister Rowland, asking if she could possibly intervene or ask the question about how long that store would be closed on Saturdays. That was forwarded in the first week of May to the CEO of Australia Post. I never heard a response. 2 months later, I received a phone call saying that the store will be closed altogether, and that will be happening from September.
How much does this impact people of Tea Tree Plaza who use that post office? Because there are a lot of local post offices around it, but I understand the Tea Tree Plaza one's a major hub.
Yeah, so I do absolutely understand the argument from Australia Post that perhaps it doesn't have the foot traffic that maybe some of the other post offices do have. But it is a hub. It's, of course, across from Aubrey Hospital, across from Service SA. You've got the Oban right there. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of employees working in the centre as well. I remember all too well working at the Plaza and going to the post office in my lunch break because that was the only opportunity I would have to use the service. And I do think that when you're looking at the footprint of an outlet like Australia Post that provides so much service to the community, you also have to be looking about where that footprint is and the impact of course, the centre that it's within and the community around it. And Westfield, of course, provides such a big service for the community. And to take out two Australia Post outlets in Westfield for South Australians over as many months, to me, is a pretty appalling decision.
So, Olivia, just what are your constituents telling you about what the alternative looks like for them in the absence of that post office?
Well, so there hasn't actually been a public announcement yet. So this is our the first time we're out here talking about the closure of the centre. But I know exactly how the residents felt when the former government wanted to close down Service SA at Modbury. I know how the residents come out together when our services are under attack. And even when the Modbury post outlet was supposed to close on Saturdays, I received a large number of letters and emails and comments on social media concerned just about the lack of a Saturday service at the centre. Mm. Now residents will be finding out, and we'll be letting everyone know, as many people as we can over the next few days and few weeks, that the outlet will be closing altogether. And I know that residents will be particularly concerned, not just because it's a local service, but because it's a service where you can get everything done, or at least where you used to be able to get everything done.
When do you think they will let people know? Is it common practice to put a sign on the door, or what are their communications going to be? Do you know?
So the staff have been let know who work at the Modbury outlet, and they have a process where they let the state and federal member know, I guess, in the week before they make a public announcement, and then I assume that once their sort of processes are finalised this week, they'll be putting a notice in the store. But we'll be letting people know as soon as possible because we'll be fighting against it. We'll be running a petition, running a campaign against it because I think it's really important to make our voices clear when we feel that services are under attack in our community.
Thank you. Olivia Savvas, MP, State Member for Newland there. So another Westfield post office set to close. Frank has texted in from Hillcrest just down the road there. Greenacres post office is now closed on Saturdays as well. You're a Western suburbs man. Does Westlakes TTP still have a post office?
Well, Westlakes still has a post office. I was there about 3 weeks ago. In fact, I think we'd just done a spot on radio talking about the Westfield Marion closure, or the potential closure. Might have been on a Wednesday morning rumour file day. And there was a lineup out into the mall proper of people paying their bills that morning. And I was looking at them thinking, so when this closes, if this closes, that one's not slated yet, but invariably it feels like we're heading in that direction. Where do these people go? And I guess now I'm particularly interested in the answer to that question for people that are affected by this most recent closure that Olivia Savvas has talked about that she's going to fight against.
Yes, September, the Modbury one's due to close.
So if you're listening to us in Modbury, what does that mean for you? Where do you go to pay your bills now?
Well, like she mentioned, those working in TTP, if you only have a 20-minute lunch break,
you've
got to do stuff. You've got to eat your lunch, got to go to a bank if there is still one there, or an ATM, got to go to the post office. I don't know. Got to do your jobs, got to buy a new pair of socks. I don't know. It affects a lot of people.
Where do you go? Because we can talk endlessly about which one's closing, but I want to talk to people, maybe people who have been affected by this recently, about, well, what has it meant in changing lifestyle for you? Because we're not necessarily talking about, but the people that are most likely to frequent post offices are probably the less able to drive an extra 5Ks and park somewhere. You know, Westfield's very available. You can get a park, you can walk in, you know what you're going to do. If you've been inconvenienced by a closure like this, call us right now and tell us what it's meant for you. 8223 0000 is the number. Faye in Windsor Gardens has just called in. Morning to you, Faye.
Yes, good morning to the both of you. You're doing very well. I would just like to talk about this business of the post office closing at the Tea Tree Plaza because I've used the post office myself, as many others would have no doubt as well, and I think it's a very inconvenient thing and very selfish. That what is the reason for this? Have we heard? Can you enlighten me a bit on that, please?
Faye, I think Olivia and I were talking off air about this just before the show, and she thinks it is, Australia Post thinks it's due to numbers, but there might be another conversation around rent. I think with two now closing at a Westfield, maybe that's telling, but I'm assuming Australia Post, like a lot of our other outlets, would say that they just don't have the numbers to be sustainable.
Yeah, I guess that's doesn't surprise me either. I mean, I guess with the internet, with the internet up and running now these days, a lot of people are using more of the internet rather than going to the post office for the ordinary paper stuff and that. But I find it found it more convenient to go there because I have a post box there myself because I've had problems with mail going astray over the years in different places where I've lived, and I think it's I think we need to hear more about this before we before we have to make plans of any sort. And is there any other post office that's closing? I heard Greenacres mentioned. Is that true,
yeah,
or
so,
am I wrong?
No, Greenacres is now closed on a Saturday. We've had a text here from Andrew saying Burnside Village Australia Post is not open Saturdays, but we might read a few more of those out after the break. Thank you, Faye, for your call and concern being a Northeast resident. If you do have more thoughts, folks, let us know, please, 8223 0000. We'll take your calls after the break. But here is traffic this morning.
Thanks, Lucy. At Enfield, two-car collision on Grand Junction Road near Main North Road. Adelaide Airport, Burst Water Main, Sir Donald Bradford Drive, that's just opposite the golf club there, speeds down to 40. And Erbera, another Burst Water Main, Glen Osmond Road at the bottom of the freeway. Busy at the moment, Port Wakefield Road at Parafield Gardens, with cameras this morning at Dags Road, Croydon Park, and Toothy Street at Unley. A massive $972 million could be yours with the USA Power Lotto. Hurry, draw closes in less than 3 hours. Grab your tickets now at lotteryoffice.com.au. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
5AA Mornings with Matthew Pantelis.
The Treasurer might want to talk about budget repair and all of that, but when electricity bills go up 20-odd percent or more, and gas too, then how do you say to people who missed out on the budgets, both federal and state, about half the population roughly, nothing in it for many people?
Weekday mornings from 9.
How do you say to them, well, you can't have your tax cut, but good luck paying your power bill or your gas bill?
On 1395, Adelaide's 5AA.
What's the best thing about winter? Definitely the Bob Burns Blinds Winter Warmer Special. Get super cozy with up to 40% off. That's up to 40% off our entire range of curtains and blinds, including our energy-efficient window coverings. With Bob Burns Blinds, you'll get that quality show home look, and you'll save money on energy bills by trapping the heat in your home. Get set for winter now with a Bob Burns Blinds Winter Warmer Special. Book your free measure and quote at bobburnsblinds.com.au.
Whether a hobby or a full-blown dairy and livestock farm, they all have one thing in common: the need for good quality steel to keep livestock safe and secure. At Nor Metals, we have just that. From rural fencing and gates to droppers, loading ramps and more, you'll find what you need for your farm. And if we don't, we'll source it for you quickly and at the best price. No matter what kind of farm you have, we'll help you out at Nor Metals, 255 Grand Junction Road, Otway.
It's time to sail away with Princess Cruises and Phil Hoffman Travel. Princess Cruises' early bird sale is on now, with up to 40% off selected 2024 season sailings. Whether you're a European explorer, Aussie adventurer or Thailand traveller, there's a cruise on offer for you with amazing early savings. Plus, cruise the latest and newest ship, Sun Princess, on her maiden Mediterranean season. T's and C's apply. Contact Phil Hoffman Travel today or visit pht.com.au.
IGA's Price Match Promise. We checked, we matched, you won't pay more. Every week we check and match the regular price of the big two supermarkets on hundreds of everyday products. Just look out for the Price Match tickets in store. Participating stores only. See website for full terms.
No more rubber duckies. Farewell bathroom floor covered in teen's clothes. So long, basin full of hair dye stains. Your home is your own now. You've earned your dream bathroom. Bathrooms by Design specializes in premium bathroom creation and installation. All our tradies, including tilers, plumbers, electricians and carpenters, are overseen by one project manager. Reward yourself every day with a luxury bathroom. Thanks to bathroomsbydesign.com.au.
Know the news with Adelaide's 7 News. Don't miss Adelaide's leading news hour tonight at 6 o'clock.
5AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
The Cherry Emoda 5, state-of-the-art driving from 33K drive away with immediate delivery. Visit Cherry Glen Osmond.
We'll hear from Roey, Timmy G and Warren Treadray shortly, but Patricia in Glenelg has called in on post offices. Morning, Patricia.
Yeah, hi, guys. Look, I just wanted to close down the thought that it might be because the post office site in Westfield, for example, is too expensive because they're closing in other places too. Mm. Now, I personally don't use them. I pay everything on a direct debit as an older woman, and I find that the easiest thing to do. But I have a sister who goes to a post office and does everything. And for her, there's one near her that's closed down on a main road down around Hendon area. But I was in Melbourne just recently. My son and his wife lived there. And there was a thriving post office on Hampton Street in Hampton, which is a suburb of Melbourne, not far out of the city, just next to Brighton. And that post office, you know, they've lived there for 15 years and that post office has been there. It was right opposite a pedestrian crossing. People would walk across from Woolworths over there. I've seen queues of people there. Mm. Last time I was in Melbourne, that post office is closed. So I think it's, you know, Australia Post are doing it and anticipating that we're all going to be doing everything online in the future. And let's face it, I mean, how often do we... Well, I mean, I never post a letter, for a start. I don't know about anybody else. But it is all of that bill paying. And I think, you know, they're just assuming that people are going to change the way they do it. But a lot of older people aren't.
Well, this is just the thing, Patricia, and that's precisely the point. Because they're right. Yeah, in 50 years, no one's going to be paying bills at a post office. But in between now and then, there's a lot of people that are going to be disenfranchised if they all just suddenly close. And they are suddenly just closing. That's what it looks and feels like as a consumer. And there's a turn of phrase that's used, and I may mangle it when it comes to what does Australia Post, how does it operate? It exists with one shareholder, and that's the federal government. So it is a pseudo-private company. It's not really. It's owned by the federal government, but it needs to run to a profit. It needs to balance its books. It can't just... There's no taxpayer money that goes to it. But at the same time, it has both a commercial and a community obligation. And I just wonder if the way it was originally set up, it was built to withstand such a shift in the way people operate and whether it can be both of those things right now at the same time. It's probably not a conversation the federal government wants to have in a cost of living crisis about bailing out Australia Post or maintaining services that aren't profitable. But I think we probably need to have a conversation about whether it's capable now of fulfilling its role as supporting the community, because there is a disenfranchised part of the community that I can imagine hear every one of these stories and absolutely shudder. It can't be both things at once.
Keep your texts coming in, 0448 08 1395. We'll read those out after the 7:30 news. But for now, it is time to get to our Roey and Timmy G sports update. $17 schnitty, Monday to Wednesday at the Albion, Birkenhead Tavern, Excelsior and Lighthouse Wharf. You just know it's a Barrow. Last night, Warren Treadray had his Monday segment. He had some mail on what could be next for Port Adelaide midfield coach Josh Carr.
I said something last week I think Port Adelaide need to be concerned at. It's called Richmond and it's Josh Carr.
You said... Now, I've had this reported to me. You said Carr, smoke, Richmond.
Yes.
Well, what's going on there? Smoke signals?
Well, they need a coach, don't they?
I believe so. Well, yeah. Got one at the moment. It's doing all right.
He's doing all right, but you also want to go to the market.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't get experience, right, and they've pretty well flagged that they want the next Damien Hardwick.
Yep.
Not three-time premiership coach, the one that started out as a really well-to-do assistant coach. Josh Carr... was at Port, then went and coached his own team at North, won a premiership, went Fremantle, look where Fremantle have gone since he's left, and look at Port Adelaide's midfield this year. And Zach Butters publicly thanks him and says thanks for pushing for me. And coaches can argue who wants where and where, put him into the midfield. And clearly it's not just Josh making that decision, but he's the one bloke Port don't want to lose.
So what are you saying?
Well, I'm saying that I'm here and Richmond are into him.
Okay.
And if they haven't made contact, they will very soon.
Okay.
And that is Port's worst nightmare because they've settled their coaching panel.
I'm going to text Josh during the break to see if there's any truth to it.
Because he'll answer your question.
Probably not.
Yeah.
Well, it would be a massive loss for Port. Josh Carr, Port people will tell you, does a wonderful job in that coaching box. I'm interested in the suggestion that they want another Damien Hardwick, that being Richmond. When they did hire Damien Hardwick, Richmond wasn't one of the plum jobs in the AFL. They were a basket case. They had been a basket case since the early 80s. They're not now. They're considered one of the that'd be one of the best jobs you can get. I suspect there's no name they couldn't get if they threw enough money at them. So I'm not sure the parameters are the same as when they had to go get a no-name guy in Damien Hardwick, as well as it worked out this time round. And that probably complicates the picture a little bit, but yeah, I can see why that would be concerning to Port people.
More on the sports show tonight from 4 o'clock with Roey and Timmy G.
Her mum's on the phone while she's on her skates.
Careful, honey, don't get too close to the road.
She rides from the top of the driveway to test how fast she can go. And suddenly...
Wait, stop!
She's testing your brakes too. Stop and take time to ensure your car stops in time. And the brakes are all you hit. Let Automasters test your brakes before someone else does. Call 1300 Automasters.
Wake up to retirement done differently with Warner Close Murray Bridge. Here in the country, we're pretty laid back. We're not about big, scary contracts, hidden fees or clauses. When you rent to retire instead, you can enjoy the little luxuries like meals, linen service, further support if you need it, even eggs from our chickens. And the biggest luxury of all, your freedom. Taste the country freedom and rent to retire. Visit warnerclose.com.au. SA community owned.
Over 60,000 Adelaide homes have said yes to saving money on their energy bills with Yes, Your Energy Saving Solutions. What's keeping you? Your Energy Saving Solutions can connect you with the SA government initiative called REPS. To save money on heating this winter, Yes is offering eligible households a 2.6 kilowatt Rinnai system for only $699. For T's and C's on this unbeatable offer from Your Energy Saving Solutions, go to yes.net.au. That's yes.net.au.
This is Adelaide's 5AA.
Mostly sunny and 17 with the 7:30 news. I'm Kendall Brantig.
Woken with a stiff neck or sore back? Get a Physio Extra appointment today. 6 locations. PhysioExtra.com.
Australia will join Germany's high-powered climate club following key talks between the leaders of both nations. More from Zach De Silva.
Prime Minister Anthony Albanese has sat down in Berlin with his German counterpart Olaf Scholz. The pair have agreed to work together to tackle climate change. Australia will join the elite climate club, which includes the US, Canada and European countries. The move could help us avoid proposed EU sanctions on nations that aren't considered to be taking serious action on global warming. The federal government says joining the club will help Australia continue to shape its climate goals as we head towards net zero emissions by 2050.
While Australia's ramping up efforts to support Ukraine, deploying defence teams and a surveillance aircraft to protect logistics hubs in Europe. 100 ADF personnel will be based in Germany for 6 months to provide military and humanitarian assistance. Two people have been arrested and police are searching for a third after a crime spree at Coffin Bay overnight. A supermarket on the Esplanade was broken into just before two, with a white ute seen fleeing the scene. Police pursued it, spiking its tyres as it headed towards Port Lincoln. The vehicle was dumped and the occupants ran into the Port Lincoln golf course. A 27-year-old and 18-year-old were arrested and charged with aggravated serious criminal trespass, theft, engaging in a police pursuit, illegal use and hindering police. A large quantity of stolen property was found in the ute, which was also stolen. Investigations are continuing to find the third offender. The price of a carton of eggs could rise to $15 if a plan to phase out caged eggs is brought forward to 2036. Industry bodies are worried the early phase-out will see nationwide shortages. Somerville free-range eggs Lou Napolitano says eventually the market will settle.
Free-range 5 years ago were probably dearer than they are today. There's a lot more free-range eggs around, so that brings the supermarket base price down a bit, but makes the branded free-range a lot dearer.
Port Wakefield Road at Paralowie's reopened after a truck lost its load of chicken carcasses early this morning. The truck had to brake suddenly at the lights, causing the carcasses to spill out of the trailer and block one of the lanes. It's been cleaned up by road transport crews. The River Torrens isn't at its best at the moment. David Bruce says recent heavy rain is to blame.
The Torrens is a real mess. There's so much filth and sludge on the waterway in the wake of rotting branches and leaves, plastic and general rubbish, even bike helmets, presumably from e-scooters. The Adelaide City Council is aware of the shocking state of the river and has employed a contractor with an excavator to help clean it up. But the problem has been that windy conditions have pushed the pollution away from the riverbanks and into the guts of the Torrens. With a bit of luck, it'll drift back to the edges so it can be scooped out within a few days.
The former US gymnastics doctor convicted of sexually assaulting athletes has been stabbed in jail. Larry Nassar's now in a stable condition after being stabbed in the neck, back and chest. During his court proceedings, more than 150 women and girls came forward to say he'd sexually abused them. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Get 10-year warranty and 10 years capped price servicing on the new Mitsubishi Outlander at Agostino Mitsubishi.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you for that, Kendall. Port Adelaide's players will hit the training track at Alberton this morning as the Power looks to extend its club record 13-game winning streak. The Power will take on Carlton at Marvel Stadium on Saturday. Assistant coach Nathan Bassett telling Rowie and Timmy G they know they've got a tricky run into the finals.
We've got some really tough games coming up.
Yeah.
Another seven games still to go, and you know, to expect us to win all of them, you know, is a very, very remote possibility.
Let's go to tennis, and Novak Djokovic wants Wimbledon matches to start earlier in the day to limit disruption caused by the 11 p.m. curfew. The defending champion won his quarterfinal against Herbert Hurkacz after they were forced off the court the night before.
Obviously, curfew is probably something that is much more difficult to change. I understand because of the community and the residential area we're in, but I think the matches could be pushed at least to start at 12 o'clock. You know, I think it would make a difference.
Stefanos Tsitsipas suffered a shock loss to unseeded American Chris Eubanks, while Ons Jabeur, Aryna Sabalenka and defending champion Elena Rybakina, they're through in the women's draw. Well, the New South Wales Origin squad will hold its captain's run this afternoon ahead of tomorrow night's Game 3 for the State of Origin. The Blues will be looking to avoid a first series clean sweep since 2010. And the Tour de France riders have enjoyed a rest day ahead of Stage 10. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now to the traffic.
G'day there at Enfield. Look out for a two-car collision, Grain Junction Road near Main North Road. Adelaide Airport got a burst water main to keep in mind today. That's on Southern Rabba Drive, just opposite the golf course. Speeds at 40. Another burst water main. This one's at Erbray at the bottom of the freeway. Busy South Road at Anzac Highway with cameras this morning. Glenburn Road, Burnside and George Street at Norwood. Save 22% off the package price at Harvey Norman when you purchase the same branded TV and soundbar in one transaction. Hurry, offer ends Thursday at Harvey Norman. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Pack away the boardies and bikinis, pull out the uggies and get your brakes checked at Automasters.
Mostly sunny and 17 today, more of the same on Wednesday and Thursday, then partly cloudy for Friday, also 17. At the moment, 12. More news as it happens on 5AA.
G'day, it's Baz from Fleurio Milk Company. South Australian dairy farmers are doing it tough right now, but at Fleurio Milk, we always look after our own, and you can too. When you reach for milk, reach for Fleurio Milk and help support our hard-working South Australian dairy farmers and their families. Because right now, they need our help. Three words make all the difference. Fleurio Milk Company. South Australian first and proud of it.
With hoodie up and head down, he's crossing the road, testing his new headphones. And then, he's testing your brakes too. Let Automasters test your brakes before someone else does. Call 1300 Automasters.
5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube.
5AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
Test drive the Cherry Emota 5 at Cherry Glen Osmond from 33K drive away with immediate delivery. Go Cherry.
7:37, beautiful morning here at Adelaide CBD. Going to be 17, mostly sunny today. We will head across to Canberra shortly to chat about all things in federal politics. But firstly, Helen in Glanville's called in on post offices. Morning, Helen.
Hello, how are you?
Oh, we're well. How are you?
Yes, I'm pretty good. There's no use moaning. we bank with a credit union, and there used to be a credit union at Port Adelaide. That closed and shifted to Westlake. We don't have transport because I'm vision impaired and my husband's not well. But we use the post office on Semaphore Road for everything, or in the Port Plaza. Now, if they close, I don't know what we're going to do because we don't have a computer. I don't want to be talking about a real sad sob story, but, you know, I mean, we can't afford one, and that's all there is to it. But can you tell me, are the post offices going to close on at Semaphore or at Port Adelaide?
Oh, Helen, I haven't heard of any more closing. I'm sure eventually they might have to if they're just a smaller post office. But, of course, there would be many in your shoes who don't have a computer and who aren't comfortable using technology to do all of their life admin. So hopefully those don't close for you. I haven't heard of any words of any more closing immediately, Helen. Mm-hmm. So we shall see. Let's jump across to Canberra now, introducing the federal... political editor, rather, of the Oz Financial Review's Phil Currie. Morning, Phil.
Hi, Lucy. How are you?
Yeah, very well, thank you.
Phil, could you sell to our listeners the value of the Prime Minister going to the NATO summit in Lithuania at a time when we've got a cost of living crisis here in Australia?
I knew you were going to ask that. and I think he was in two minds about going too, Will, because it is, you know, it is a bit marginal, but at the end of the day, he sort of had to go. The trouble is, you know, NATO now invites this sort of block of four Indo-Pacific leaders, the Australians, I think the Kiwis, the Japanese, and one other, I can't remember, it might be the Koreans, because, you know, the Russian invasion of Ukraine is basically more than just a European issue. It's an issue of, you know, violation of sovereign borders. And so it's about, by incorporating the Indo-Pacific nations, it's about... you know, showing a solidarity both to Ukraine but also warning against China. So it's all sort of tied up in this sending messages to the world. You know, the world's no longer really good about regions because it's all so global. So that's sort of the broad reason we're there. You know, we're not a key player, obviously. The PM dropped into Germany on the way over because it's a long way to go to Lithuania and back in the air as long as you're on the ground. So he's sort of bolted on this trip to Germany where he's sort of announced not very much, and then he's going to be straight back home afterwards. But yeah, I think he's conscious of the fact that being away at such a time, it isn't looking great, but I think at the end of the day, they've really got no choice. If you don't turn up at these things, you'll create more problems than you solve.
We seem to dip a toe in the water every now and then to the global arms dealership. Trade, and did so with these armoured vehicles that have been sold to Germany. Do you think that the federal government has designs on us being a bigger player in this space? Obviously, that's a generational thing. It's not a near-term thing.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, it's a big industry. It's a big export industry. I mean, that was a pretty significant deal we've done with the Germans. So it's $1 billion in vehicles that are going to be made in Queensland, I think. So, I mean, I don't know if the Prime Minister actually needed to go there to announce it himself, but had to justify the trip. But I don't think it's going to be a global arms deal. I suspect we'll be announcing it a bit more on the sidelines of the NATO summit about Ukraine, but maybe we might be giving a bit more. But the Prime Minister did announce we're sending an aeroplane, a surveillance aircraft, which is going to fly around European airspace and help coordinate all the relief efforts and everything going into Ukraine. But, you know, this time last year, Will, we were in Madrid, and that was important that Albanese was at that one. That was the big first NATO summit since Russia did invade Ukraine. It was important all the nations, you know, went there and sent a message, not just to Russia, but to other nations like China, that this sort of rubbish won't be tolerated. So I guess this is just a hangover of that more than anything else.
How much longer do you think Scott Morrison's going to hang around in Parliament for?
Oh, till he finds a job. I don't think he's going anywhere in a hurry. And in fact, I mean, the more people who say he should go, he'll dig in because he's stubborn. He's not known for having a reverse gear. So if you tell him he's got to go, then he won't go. Look, he'll go as soon as he can find some work. Like, this is an interesting issue, Will, because you know he's not old, Morrison. He's only sort of mid-50s. He's got kids at school and a mortgage, you know, Sydney mortgage. So if he needs an income, and he's, other than Malcolm Turnbull, he's our first Prime Minister to be elected after 2004. And if you remember, John Howard, in a fit of panic under pressure from Mark Layton, abolished that sort of fairly generous pension scheme that we used to have for politicians. And so anyone elected from 2004 onwards isn't entitled to it. So Scott Morrison gets no pension. Yeah. He has no income if he leaves Parliament. He has to find a job. And so that's the reason he's been hanging around as long as he has. He would have gone a while ago if he'd been able to stick something up. I mean, he's probably doing all right financially, but he can't retire. You know, fund all his bills like anyone else. So, I wrote a piece a while ago which was as popular as Boyle's, but I think, you know, it's not about Scott Morrison, but it's about the office of Prime Minister. I think we have to consider just a pension for former Prime Ministers, you know, just some sort of stipend so they can exit the place, you know, gracefully and disappear, not have to sort of rattle the tin and look for work in the capacity as former Prime Minister. And, you know, it presents a lot of problems when they hang around if they don't want to hang around. And, you know, this one's got a lot of baggage, as we're starting to see, with, you know, first the secret ministries and then this Royal Commission's been most unfavourable to him. So he's a huge thorn in the side now for Peter Dutton. As long as he's there, it just reminds people of a lot of people why they voted him out. And, it makes it very hard for the coalition to sort of pick up the pieces and move on.
Thank you, Phil. Phil Currie there, political editor from the Oz Financial Review over in Canberra, where it was minus 0.6 this morning.
Very cold.
It is trial by jury time, Will. And I haven't had the pleasure of even playing our intro to it.
There feels it good. Give it a whirl.
In the criminal justice system, all defendants are innocent until proven guilty, either by confession, plea bargain, or trial by jury. This is one of those trials.
Had a call from Linda, I think it was, before 7 o'clock with regard to a family member of hers who just embarked on a family trip to Cairns. They arrived, their bags did not. Bizarrely, I think just 13 bits of luggage came off a plane, a fully laden plane full of people from Adelaide to Cairns, and some other arrangements had to be made. We got subsequent texts from people saying, flying in this country is a joke at the moment. We are in the midst of the holiday travel period now. It is school holiday time in Adelaide. The busiest travel day is, I think, Monday next week.
Yeah, the 17th of July will be the biggest influx through Adelaide Airport, and I guess outflux, not really a word, but people coming in and out of the airport, Monday the 17th.
That'll be the busy day. What we wanted to do for the jury trial this morning is get a sense from you about what your most recent experience flying was like. Was it stress-free or stressful for the jury trial this morning, flying on an Australian airline, stress-free or stressful? Let's get a sense of what 5AA listeners' experiences have been like. The ones that have been coming through on the text line have not been glowing, shall we say. 8223 00 00, you can text us, but we want some jurors. Tell us, stress-free or stressful?
We'll get to your votes after the break, but first let's check traffic for your run-in.
Thanks, Lucy. A couple of burst water mains to look out for this morning. One of the Adelaide airports onto the Narrabri Drive, just opposite the golf club there. Speeds at 40. Airbray burst water main, Glenelg Road at the bottom of the freeway. Busy South Road at Anzac Highway. Also, 5S Drive at Pasadena busy. And look out for cameras this morning. Greenhill Road, Burnside, and Hallett Road at Stonyfell. Find your perfect winter break at Big Four Holiday Parks with hundreds of amazing deals on offer. Don't miss out. Go big for winter deals and book now at big4.com.au. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Need a forklift? Don't just get a forklift, get a Toyota forklift. Toyota is the world's number one forklift brand, with a great range of pallet jacks, walkie stackers and reach forklifts, right up to their leading Toyota counterbalance forklifts. Legendary reliability and safety, with cleaner, greener electric options, Toyota can tailor the right forklift solution for you. It's all part of the Toyota forklift advantage. For more, visit toyotamaterialhandling.com.au.
Get a Toyota forklift.
What's winter looking like for solar owners? With the upcoming energy increases, many solar owners can expect huge power bills from using expensive electricity at night, like running heaters. But with adding a solar battery from NRG Solar, you don't need to stress. We'll help you cure that winter bill, and we'll help you pay off that battery even sooner. We'll set you up with 13.5 kilowatt hours of storage, a 10-year warranty, blackout protection, and an awesome app for monitoring it on your phone. Don't wait. Visit nrgsolar.com.au today.
Cheese, crepes, champagne. Merci beaucoup.
I'm looking forward to this Friday because Bastille Day is back at the market and you can celebrate France's national holiday over two exciting days, this Friday the 14th and Saturday the 15th of July.
And there is plenty lined up over the weekend, so grab tickets for the French walking tour or the paint and sip class, or you can enjoy free kids activities and cooking demonstrations.
Not to mention the French wine bar, crepes and more, with live music to set to that timeless French bistro atmosphere.
Stock up on all your favourite French goodies this Friday and Saturday with Bastille Day at the Adelaide Central Market. Think baguettes, croissants, small goods, and the best bit, the cheese. So support local and get a taste of France, see the full program, and book at adelaidecentralmarket.com.
Speak with One Solution and they'll tell you cybercrime is not a big business problem, a government problem, or a small enterprise problem. It's everyone's problem. Ransomware, malware, and adware remain the number one threat. One call to One Solution will put your business in a safe place. It's the smartest, most cost-effective business decision you'll ever make. Get in touch with One Solution, winner of the National Telstra Customer Experience Award. OneSolution.net.au.
5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube.
5AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
The Cherry Emoda 5, state-of-the-art driving from 33K drive away with immediate delivery. Visit Cherry Glen Osmond.
11 away. Lots of horror stories this morning from people talking about travelling during the holidays at the moment, or more recently, experiences travelling on planes in Australia. We've spoken to David Kosh about it. As I say, we've got some texts on it. We're asking you for the jury this morning whether your experience flying has been stress-free or stressful. Maybe I should put it this way as well. If you had to fly, given everything you've heard, stress-free or stressful would you find the experience? 8223 0000. All jurors, of course, remain totally anonymous, but render your verdict on the state of travel in Australia at the moment, because certainly we get to hear all the squeaky wheels on the 5AA, but I'm interested to get a sense of what people have found themselves in travel, or family members as well, like Linda's, who had that horror situation of no bags or anything turning up to their holiday destination in Cairns. Lots of people having their say about this, the post office moves and what it means in terms of changes to their lifestyle. And I think this tweet I got from Bernice, this sums it up. Bernice says, just listening to you regarding post offices closing, I regularly pay bills at Castle Plaza. Over recent months, the post office there has closed on Saturdays. My bank was there, but that closed a couple of years ago. So some bills I need to go to Adelaide via tram from Plympton. We surely can't be fast approaching a scenario where everyone needs to travel into the city of Adelaide to do something as basic and fundamental as paying their bills. But I suspect Bernice is not alone. If that's your story, call in and tell us, 8223 0000.
Kay says as well, no one's mentioned that not only do we go there to pay other bills, but renewing driver's licence, passport for photos, send parcels, and now we are expected to do banking there. It is, the post office is now the one-stop shop, and for those that disappear from our lives, it does create a huge issue for lots of people's everyday life admin. Another one said earlier, it's a pain when you can only go to a post office on a Saturday because you work full time and your life doesn't allow midweek visits, and then when it closes on a Saturday, then what?
Mm.
How does that even work? Gary in Collinswood's called in on post offices. Morning, Gary.
Good morning. Yeah, a couple of things. I'll be very quick. Yeah, they want to close post offices down, banks down. We'll all be just sitting down at home, twiddling our thumbs. Now, I know people have rang up and said, oh, yes, you can pay all this online. Mm. And I've always said, well, what's in for me? And they said, well, what do you mean by that? I said, well, am I going to get cheaper registration or cheaper electricity? No. Oh, so I'm getting them, I'm doing all the work, and they're getting the money.
Yep.
Now, not everybody, it's not just old people, there's younger people, can't all afford a computer either, you know. They're not cheap. Here's a suggestion, I know it's a real silly one, what about if all these CEOs take a bit of a pay cut? Well, that's a silly idea, isn't it?
Well, I think bitter experience will tell us, Gary, that's simply not going to happen. But you wonder, CEOs get bonuses on the basis of KPIs. Now, if you're getting bonus at the same time, you're meant to be providing a community service and the community can't get access to it. I just wonder what your KPIs are, because they're clearly wrong. It can't all be about the bottom line. We're talking about an authority that has to run like a private company, but it's hard. It's run by the federal government. And we have never come across a time like this before where the nature of interacting with that service has been disrupted like it has. So maybe it's time for a total rethink in how it operates.
Mick in Colonel Light Gardens shares your sentiments there, Gary. Hi, will the Australia Post CEO have their exorbitant salary cut accordingly as each services to the public are slashed? I think that is a common thought amongst our audience this morning. Let's get to John Blake, who is, of course, back on air this week from 7 o'clock, and you can hear him twice in Breakfast. Aussie Fast Transport Solutions, interstate freight, distribution, warehousing and local Adelaide couriers. Call Aussie Fast, 13 13 64.
Now, the latest news with Wallace Fogg.
Good morning, early risers. This is Wallace Fogg with another 5AA news update. Former Adelaide City Councillor Anne Moran has declared that she would be open to running for council again, saying, I'd like to still contribute to the community in some way. Ms. Moran lost her seat at the big table last November after 27 years on council, following a final four-year term in which the council was consumed by bitter infighting between the dominant Team Adelaide faction and the Independents, with Ms. Moran deciding that Team Adelaide were mostly made up of halfwits. She said, as to the possibility of throwing my hat in to run in a central ward election, which may be held this year, I wouldn't completely rule it out. When the news hit, some unconfirmed rumours said that former Team Adelaide councillor Mary Kouros violently vomited on her cornflakes. In other news, recent studies have suggested that as many as 1 in 22 people could be psychopaths, meaning we're likely to walk past plenty of psychopaths as we go about our daily business. While we may have an idea of what a psychopath looks like, the reality is vastly different to what plays out in Hollywood films such as The Shining, starring Jack Nicholson. The study revealed also that there may be an optimal level of psychopathic tendencies for leadership effectiveness. In fact, some psychopaths go on to enjoy extremely successful careers and will climb to leadership positions such as CEOs, general managers, and market leads. There are two main bosses here at 5AA and Nova Entertainment, and both are very effective in their leadership skills, leading us to believe that both of them are clearly psychopaths. And finally, very exciting news that a South Australian farmer has developed a tearless onion, which will change the way we enjoy our cooking. The new variety of onion, marketed as Happy Chop Tearless Onions, contain fewer of the compounds and enzymes which cause our tear ducts to go off every time we slice into one. They have a great onion flavour and are slightly sweeter than regular brown onions. They're grown right here in South Australia, and an excited Woolworths spokesman said the new variety will be available at Woolworths in New South Wales, Victoria and the ACT.
Sorry I wasted your time with that one.
And that's the news for this Tuesday. I'm Wallace Fogg. More 5AA news coming up at 8 o'clock. We're as close as we can get.
They cost about twice as much as regular onions, those onions.
$2.50 for 500 grams. And regular onions are about a dollar for 500 grams, I think, something like that.
We're going to talk cost of living in the next hour of the program. There was an interesting poll that came out that's in the Oz this morning that we've been talking about in 5AA News regarding some 13% of the population think the federal government is doing enough. Onions is an interesting conversation because it's about innovation. Eggs is another component of this. We're going to be talking about laws to bring forward changes to where our eggs come from that might mean significant changes in the cost of eggs that might rule them out. And to that end, we'd love to hear from you on 8223 0000. Given the cost of living crisis that we're in at the moment, is there anything you've stopped buying? Is there anything that you've cut out of your shop? Something that used to be a feature? It could be food, it could be convenience, it could be confectionery, whatever it might well be. Is there anything you just say, now that's too expensive, I'm not going to do it? Have you drawn the line somewhere on the shopping list? Let us know, because in the next hour of the show, we're going to be talking a lot about cost of living on 8223 0000.
Last time I went to Woolworths to buy some eggs, they didn't have any six-pack of eggs. It was only a dozen. Mm. You could only buy a dozen. And there were shortages for sure, but I'm not sure the reasoning why. Perhaps it's too hard, or not too hard, but too costly to be making the six carton holders.
Yeah, it might be a unit cost thing.
But now I don't eat a lot, and it takes me a while to work my way through 12 eggs. So I'm eating a lot of eggs now because I don't want to waste them. Mm. Because I noticed the price of eggs went up and I had to buy a dozen. I wanted one egg, or I had to buy a dozen, which is fine. I happily support our local farmers, and I know the Roadies in the Clare Valley. I grew up with the Roadies. They're massive free-range egg farmers, and I'd happily to support them. But if I don't get through 12 eggs, well, then that's just a waste. So the problem doesn't stop with availability and the cost of things. It's, well, what happens if you don't get through it, or worse, it goes off or it's bad quality? Ongoing discussion with our shops. We will be joined by Frank Mano from Farmhouse Fresh SA after 8 o'clock to chat about the cost of living and eggs.
Babe, why is there a boat in our driveway?
Yes.
And new golf clubs in the laundry?
Right, well,
and do you know anything about a holiday booking in the Maldives?
Yeah, babe.
Did we win the lottery?
Babe.
Did you get a promotion?
Babe.
Oh, no. You're having a midlife crisis.
Babe, chill. I went to Cosco Energy Group.
Cosco?
Yeah, K-O-Z-C-O. They've installed a new solar system on the roof, so now we're saving on power.
Cosco Energy Group, the experts at reducing your power costs. Cosco.com.au.
Babe, why is there a motorbike helmet on the table?
If you need to fix your pipes, call Precise.
Call Precise.
If your toilet's clogging up, call Precise.
Call Precise.
If your lights aren't turning on, or your hot water is gone, or a plumber or an electrician, call Precise.
Precise.
Precise Plumbing and Electrical. Call 1300 700 200. That's 1300 700 200. For fixed price services, call Precise.
For a plumber or an electrician, call Precise.
Call Precise.
When you're gone, who gets the things most precious to you? Like your highly valued comic book collection or your 1976 Tirana in mint condition? If you don't have a will, you'll never know. Donlan Lawyers specialise in wills and estate planning. From the simplest to the most complex, Donlan Lawyers will give effect to your wishes. For wills and estate planning, visit donlanlawyers.com. Hindmarsh Square, Adelaide, and Ocean Street, Victor Harbour.
Online, on DAB Digital Radio, and on 1395 AM, Talking Adelaide. This is Adelaide's 5AA.
Mostly sunny and 17. With the 8 o'clock news, I'm Kendall Brettig.
Looking for the perfect winter exercise? Physio Extra offers clinical Pilates at 6 locations. PhysioExtra.com.
Senior Labor ministers have rejected a new opinion poll showing the Albanese government isn't focused on cost of living issues. The survey conducted by the CT Group shows Australians aren't confident in the government's economic management. The only area where Labor's doing well is national security. But Acting Prime Minister Richard Marles says easing cost of living pressures is very much front and centre for the government.
We now see much more affordable childcare operating in Australia. We put in place cheaper medicines. We pushed through the parliament against the opposition of the Liberal and National parties, measures which saw a downward pressure being placed on power bills.
Well, the Prime Minister has announced Australia will deploy a Royal Australian Air Force wedge-tail aircraft to Germany to help protect logistics hubs which provide critical support to Ukraine. The six-month deployment's closer to the front line than any Australian forces have gotten during the war. Anthony Albanese says it's a significant contribution.
Both for what it will do, but also for what it symbolises as well, which is Australia's commitment to doing what we can to provide the appropriate resources.
While the cost of an Australian postage parcel may soon rise again, making it even more expensive to send a package. Since 2008, prices have increased 136% as cost of living pressures continue to bite. Former chairman of the Supply Chain and Logistics Association of Australia, Mark Skipper, says members raised the issue over a decade ago.
And you look at the Reserve Bank website, the inflation rate has been 38.7% over the same period. So they've jacked up the parcel prices 3.5 times the inflation or CPI rate, which is huge.
And there are reports the cost of a carton of eggs could rise to $15 if a plan to phase out caged eggs is brought forward. A meeting of federal and state agriculture ministers this week will discuss a proposal to fast-track the phase-out by 10 years, bringing the end date forward to 2036. Managing a free-range farm is said to be 3 times more expensive than a caged operation. Speed limits are set to be cut on our beaches in time for summer. It's currently 100 k's an hour where there's no signed limit, but after extensive public consultation, the state government wants to reduce that to 40. Police Minister Joe Sockarch says it's in the interests of public safety.
People have been telling us very clearly that beaches are a beautiful place. They're where we see cars and individuals sharing the space, so a common sense reduction in a shared space is one that's been widely supported.
Some popular beaches like Moana, Aldinga and Selix already have 10k speed limits. President Joe Biden kicked off his trip to Europe with a visit to London. He's met with his British counterpart Rishi Sunak and King Charles. The war in Ukraine topped the agenda, the President and Prime Minister emphasising the two countries are lockstep on key issues.
Our relationship is rock solid. People in the United States, Great Britain, and I look forward to our discussions.
Yeah, me too. Great to have you here. Thanks very much.
A 48-year-old man accused of stealing Bowie, a beloved blind dog from a Gold Coast home last week, has been granted bail. It's on condition he resides with his sister in Sydney until he faces court again in August. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Get 10-year warranty and 10 years capped price servicing on the new Mitsubishi Outlander at Agostino Mitsubishi.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Port Adelaide will be keeping a close eye on ruckman Scott Lysett when the club trains at Alberton this morning. The 30-year-old has missed the past 2 weeks with a knee injury. Meantime, Essendon is weighing up an appeal against the one-game ban handed to Andrew Phillips for rough conduct. Phillips was suspended for bumping Adelaide's Riley O'Brien in the head whilst attempting a shepherd. To tennis now, the quarterfinals at Wimbledon are locked in. Craig Gabriel reports from the All England Club.
Last year at Wimbledon, the Russian and the Belarusian players were banned. Now at the quarterfinal stage this year, there are 4 players across the men's and women's draws from those nations. Arina Sabalenka, Daniil Medvedev, Andrei Rublev and Roman Safiulin. Sabalenka and Medvedev had straightforward passages. Rublev and Safiulin advanced the day before. Rublev will face Novak Djokovic and Safiulin will play Jannik Sinner. Wins also for Elena Rybakina and Ons Jabeur, and Chris Eubanks stunned Stefanos Tsitsipas.
To cricket, Australian selectors have been left with plenty to ponder ahead of the 4th Ashes test in Manchester, which begins next week, with all-rounder Cameron Green set to put his hand up after missing the 3rd test at Headingley. But Mitch Marsh is unlikely to lose his place after a brilliant century, meaning any of Dave Warner, Todd Murphy or Scott Boland could make way. The Socceroos and New Zealand All Whites will clash in London in October for the rediscovered Soccer Ashes trophy. Meantime, Ange Postecoglou will present his vision for Tottenham to Harry Kane when he reports for pre-season training this week amid interest in the Spurs captain from rival clubs in Europe. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now to the traffic.
Good morning. At Wingfield, there's a breakdown slowing things up today on the north-south motorway, just near the interchange roundabout. Adelaide Airport boost water main. It's on Southern Brambler Drive, just opposite the golf club. Splits at 40. And Airbrake boost water main there too. Glen Osmond Road at the bottom of the freeway. Busy south road at Anzac Highway. Also 5 Ash Drive at Pasadena. With cameras, Green Hill Road, Burnside, and Hallett Road at Stonyfield. It's DIY July and Bunnings can help you get it done for less. Head in store or check out the Bunnings website for project inspiration and advice this DIY July. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Pack away the bikinis and boardies, pull out the woolies and get your brakes checked at Automasters.
Mostly sunny and 17 today, more of the same on Wednesday and Thursday, tops of 17, and then partly cloudy for Friday, also 17. At the moment, 12. More news as it happens on 5AA.
5 Good morning to you on this Tuesday morning, top of 17 today. Already a sunny start to the morning. If you've got any beautiful sunrise photos, we would love to see them on the Dutton's text line, 0448 08 1395. Coming up for the rest of the show, my movie review of Monty Python's Meaning of Life.
Looking forward to that.
Did I find the meaning of life? All shall be revealed. After 8:30, we will excitingly be joined by Aussie songstress Marsha Hines. Very excited to speak with Marsha. And then, of course, after 9 o'clock this morning, the morning show will be hosted by Will's dad, Graham Goodings, in the chair for 2 weeks.
We've been talking about cost of living on the program, Luce, in the last few moments. There's a text here from Penny that I think frames the discussion nicely. Penny says, no more scotch fillet on the barbecue, it snags and rissoles. What have you cut out of your weekly shop? What's just too expensive right now? Cost of living has been the subject of a poll that just come out in The Australian. There's some of the results we've been hearing about in 5AA News.
A new survey shows just 13% of voters believe the government is doing enough to ease cost of living pressures. The polling published by The Australian shows a majority of Australians believe national security is the only issue being handled well.
National security being handled well. The Prime Minister's over at NATO at the moment to talk about that organisation's foray into the Indo-Pacific. That's all very important stuff. But right now we're talking about the price of eggs. You can get eggs at about $5.20 a carton, we found was the cheapest we found looking around. That might become $15. And this is not so much a story about inflation, it is about regulation, because that would be a byproduct of a change to the phasing out of caged eggs being brought forward. And New Zealand, as a test case, has seen the price of eggs go up to $15 a carton. I wonder for how many people they'd suddenly find eggs would be ruled out of the weekly shop. Frank Mano is the managing director of Farmhouse Fresh here in South Australia. Frank, good morning to you. Is that headline alarmist or does that sound spot on to you?
It's definitely spot on. We've definitely got some very serious issues. Farmhouse Fresh is one of the biggest in Australia. We supply nursing homes. We do a host of Indigenous stores. Very, very remote. We do places all over Australia. The problem we have is that we're having to cast our net a lot greater now to get more eggs in, and which is shortening the market. But if you stop cage eggs, I don't think $15 is unreasonable in years to come. And I don't think this has been thought out very well. Eggs are a protein staple in a lot of diets. Not to mention, you know, everyday Australians, but you've also got remote places that rely on them. So you remove that from the food supply, I think it's going to get really ugly. But no one's actually discussing it. Everyone's just happy to bring it forward.
So what was the original time frame? So it'd be brought forward by 10 years to 2036?
That's correct. The problem with that is, and people say, well, that's heaps of time. No, it's not, because you've got to understand the caged egg people have to make maintenance and reinvestment decisions. They run a business like everybody else. And if they know that it's been brought forward, a lot of them are going to start winding down well before that date. So we might see some pretty ugly scenes in Australia within 5 years or less. We've got to give them that extra time so people will reinvest and we can bring up the other areas, you know, barn laid, free range, whatever it may be, to come in and meet the supply demand that's there. Otherwise, there's just going to be this incredible situation where you may not even get eggs at periods. And that's not acceptable to me. It's such an important part of the Australian, especially breakfast.
Yeah.
It's crazy. I don't understand it personally.
So I'm just trying to think through the process by which the industry undertakes the changes that you're talking about, Frank. It sounds as though some cost increases are inevitable irrespective of what time frame we use?
Yes, some cost increases are, but having said all of the above, the current pricing is also, there's a couple of other pressures that are associated with that. Now, those costs can be alleviated if these caged egg suppliers knew that they had more time up their sleeve, because they would then reinvest in their own farms and expand supply production, which is fantastic. But they're not doing it because they're saying, look, there's a finite date on this, and while, you know, I don't know, 12, 13 years seems a long time to most people, it's not. Mm. And that was never the original arrangement. The original arrangement was supposed to be 2046, I think it was. So it was going to give everyone another cycle, and that period would have given people time to transition to the other kind of egg supply chains. That's not happening. And the people that are currently doing cage, they're going to start reducing their efforts on their own places, saying that, you know, this is coming to an end. So it won't be that it'll get to 2036 and they'll go to whatever they'll be. I mean, New Zealand hit $15. I'm pretty sure they hit $20 at one stage over there. Now, you imagine, you know, poor old mum goes to the supermarket and pays $20 for a dozen eggs. That's just not acceptable. I'm really sorry. This is not a third world country. We're dealing with third world issues here. Yeah. This is a joke. We need to be making eggs, which is not a luxury by any means, a staple part of the Australian diet. And by regulation that's causing this, that really upsets me, because it's not like we couldn't expand caged egg area. And we're not saying it would go forever. It would just have to go for a little longer so the other supply chains can meet the demand.
Frank, just with your work at the SA Produce Market, generally, what kind of conversations are you having with shoppers who come and they want eggs and can't afford to get them every time, or with other products? What kind of conversations are you hearing?
Well, the scary part is people are paying the money, which is, you know, because the whole industry understands that there is a supply issue, right? And it's all based around this regulation. Things are coming to the end. A lot of you know, cage people are not reinvesting in their farms and structures because they're worried about the end date. They'd rather finish before than after. So the people that are coming in, the shoppers that are coming into our store 1920 at the produce market, they're telling us very simply that we need eggs. So we've gone out and tried to get as many as we can, but the problem is we're now spreading the net wider and we're bringing in Victorian growers, which is causing a shortage. But it is getting to the stage where people can't buy the same quantity. Like, people are having them now as they, you know, just have on the shelf. They're making them expensive, so they slow the sales down, but it's not working because people are going to the chain stores and finding no eggs. So the basic demand is getting greater than ever, which is what's causing the price to go up. And as I say, this could all be resolved fairly easily by extending out that regulatory date that they want to finish it on, to give the cage farmers more time and then allow, you know, the non-caged to come in and meet that demand. But it's going to take time. I mean, farms and costs are quite high, so you're going to need time for that demand to meet the finishing up demand.
Frank, thank you for your insight this morning on what is a Tuesday morning. Also, your birthday, I believe.
Who told you that?
Ask your brother.
All right. I was going to say, you don't celebrate birthdays after 50, I was told.
No,
happy birthday to you,
Frank. Happy birthday to you, Frank.
Thanks for your
time this morning. Excellent insight. Frank Mano there, the Managing Director of Farmhouse Fresh SA. You may have seen him at the SA Produce Markets as well.
This is one of those issues that's in a suite of things I like to think it makes no sense right now. It makes no sense right now. There may be merit. We got a text from someone saying, guys, maybe the chickens are happy with the date being brought forward. They are. And I think there's merit in the idea of phasing out caged hens. But we are in a cost of living crisis. That's not a cute phrase that the media dreamt up. People are struggling to pay bills, mortgages. There's distress. Shops, businesses are struggling and closing because people can't go and buy and frequent them in the same volume they are. This is a great idea that makes no sense in 2023. It makes no sense to be putting cost pressures on industries that are already suffering. It makes no sense to put cost pressures on consumers that are struggling to buy things. Look at these texts we're getting on the Dutton's text line. Mike says, price of cheese has skyrocketed. A pack of 24 slices, almost $10. And that doesn't go far when you've got three teenage boys in the house. Karen says, I save money when I go shopping by not buying any treats. no chocolate or biscuits for me anymore. So Karen does that, and I think the natural reaction to that is, well, okay, well, maybe we could all do with fewer chocolates or biscuits. Well, not if you're in a chocolate or biscuit business.
And not if that's your way of mental sanity.
Totally.
People sometimes have their vices, mine's salt and vinegar chips. The price of potato chips has gone up. That's annoying for people who really love chocolate and want a bit of chocolate at the end of a stressful work day. Or that's just disappointing that you can't even treat yourself to a bar of chocolate because you have to choose between bread and milk or chocolate or petrol or eggs or food for your family.
There are just a suite of issues that need to be parked right now. Need to be parked. You might be really passionate about it and you've advocated it and you've finally got movement in Canberra or state politics or wherever. Well, that's great, but not right now. Makes no sense right now.
Very passionate there, Will. I love it. Let's move on to another cost of living discussion, which we do check the fuel situation every morning. If you are out on the roads and you're thinking, gosh, I can only put in $10 or $20 into your fuel, yeah, that's probably accurate because it has jumped up to the high $1.80s at the moment. But you can find the cheapest fuel in an instant. Download the free RAA app from your app store today. A few cheaper ones this morning. The OTR on Marion Road in Marion's $1.63. The United Main South Road, Old Norlunga's $1.62. The United on Main North Road in Paraka's $1.59. Same as the Liberty on Hampstead Road, Clearview, also $1.59, and diesel $1.67 at the X Convenience on Henley Beach Road in Brooklyn Park. Coming up shortly, my movie review, all thanks to Wallace Cinemas of Monty Python's Meaning of Life. I'm still sad I didn't get to watch Chevy Chase's Vacation. One day when David returns, maybe it'll be on the repercharge list, but coming up is The Meaning of Life. Did I find it? You shall find out. Here is your traffic though.
At Wingfield, there's a breakdown on the north-south motorway near the interchange roundabouts. Adelaide Airport, Burst Waterline slowing things up this morning. It's on Southern Rapid Drive just opposite the golf club. Speeds at 40. And another Burst Waterline, this one's at Erbrae, Glen Osmond Road at the bottom of the freeway. Busy South Road at Anzac Highway with cameras this morning, Addison Road, Pennington, and Chief Street at Brompton. Servicing your Mini has never been so easy and cost-effective with full vehicle servicing from $298 at Glenelg Mini Garage. T's and C's apply. LMCT 8953. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Rowie and Timmy G on the 5AA Sports Show.
The story of the weekend. Oh, the T-Birds.
That is a great championship.
How good a moment. Don't play finals for 10 years and then you get in and you win it. What was interesting, I sent Tanya Obst, the coach, a text message to say, congratulations, well done.
Rowie and Timmy G.
I had a look at the previous text I sent. I was actually congratulating her on one win. You know, and that's how far they've come in such a short time.
4 p.m. weekdays on 5AA.
There's nothing worse than being in a home where it feels colder inside than out. Don't wait until cooler months arrive to get a new heating system installed. Get it done now with an automated system from Cosco Energy Group. It could save you some serious dollars and you'll never have to layer up to beat the cold chill again. Experience the automated heating solutions at the Cosco Energy Group's interactive showroom, 336 South Road, Croydon Park. KOZCO, Cosco Energy Group.
Speak with One Solution and they'll tell you cybercrime is not a big business problem, a government problem, or a small enterprise problem. It's everyone's problem. Ransomware, malware, and adware remain the number one threat. One call to One Solution will put your business in a safe place. It's the smartest, most cost-effective business decision you'll ever make. Get in touch with One Solution, winner of the National Telstra Customer Experience Award. OneSolution.net.au.
G'day, it's Baz from Fleurieu Milk Company. Just wanted to make sure you knew that our milk only comes from SA Dairy Farmers. So make sure the milk you buy is only from SA Dairy Farms. Because you see, no matter how tough it gets out there, our dairy farmers always put you first. So let's support them. Look for Fleurieu Milk Company products in your supermarket. Three words make all the difference. Fleurieu Milk Company. South Australian first and proud of it.
Some builders think a sloping block has limitations. When Beechwood Homes look at a sloping block, they think, ah, the possibilities. Beechwood Homes know how to make the most of a sloping block. In fact, they specialise in them. Beechwood will design a home that works with the land you have, taking full advantage of every square metre. So if you're looking at a sloping block, go for it. Beechwood has your back. Life's good. It's even better in a Beechwood home. Google Beechwood Adelaide.
Gentlemen, is the urge to pee all the time getting in the way of your everyday life? Caruso's Pee Less to the rescue. Caruso's P-Less is a unique herbal formula that relieves urinary frequency and helps support healthy bladder and prostate function. So, if you'd like to pee less, try Caruso's P-Less today. Caruso's P-Less is made in Australia and comes with a money-back guarantee. Available from leading pharmacies and health stores. Always read the label and follow the directions for use.
Know the news with Adelaide's 7 News. Don't miss Adelaide's leading news hour tonight at 6 o'clock.
Five AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
The Cherry Emoda 5, state-of-the-art driving from 33K drive away with immediate delivery. Visit Cherry Glen Osmond.
8.22 on your Tuesday morning. Couple of Dutton's texts here. Volkswagen Tiguan All Space, the 7-seater that's perfect for weekends away, camping trips and the crazy Saturday sports rush. Just about the cost of living. Morning, Lucy and Will. Who dreamt up the appalling Karen's Diner business model where rude service as an appealing novelty would be a fun way to dine? Insolvent now with $4.3 million owed to probably a lot of mum and dad businesses servicing these establishments. Thank you, Paul and McGill.
Every time I walked past the one on East Terrace, I think it was,
yep.
It looked like it was full. So it surprised me that it's gone bust. I never went there. I mean, you know. If you want people to say rude things to you, you just say something online. You don't need to go and pay for a dinner.
The food, from what I heard, was quite good, like a standard sort of burger, chips type dining setup. But I think rude service is a novelty for about 2 minutes.
Wonder if any of our listeners ever went there. 8223 0000. Let us know if you did, and would have you gone back had they continued to trade?
Had they not gone insolvent? Movies are better on the big screen at Wallace Cinemas, Mitchum, Mount Barker, Norlunga and the Piccadilly, wallace.com.au. It is time for my movie review of Monty Python's Meaning of Life. I have seen Life of Brian. I haven't seen Search for the Holy Grail. So no doubt the other Monty Python will pop up. I had a bit of trouble once again finding both of our films. I know last time I absolutely lambasted Apple TV for making me pay to watch after I'd already signed up for them. Same situation again. So we did some digging and finally Sam bought for me this movie. Thank you, Sam. I'll shout you a coffee. Either way, I did get to watch eventually Monty Python's The Meaning of Life, which of course does tackle the full spectrum of human existence, and it is a satirical look at society's biggest issues that were in the 1980s. It pokes fun at Catholicism and authoritative figures in day-to-day life, whilst also pointing out that perhaps we will never truly know the full meaning of life. The six of the Monty Python troupe brought their musical numbers to life, especially the old classic, All Sperm is Good. that was a highlight. Without being too woke, I feel, though, it didn't age too well. The jokes were very outdated, but I did appreciate the cleverness behind the scripting and the humour. Overall, I give it 3 stars.
3's not bad for you for a comedy.
3 is not bad. I did give Life of Brian 3.5. I gave this one 3 stars.
Does this make you want to more or less watch Holy Grail?
Oh, I'll watch it, yeah. Mm. If it's in the bowl, I will watch it.
Do you think it's the subject matter or the things that haven't dated well, or is the style of the comedy a bit jarring, do you think?
That as well.
Yeah.
Like I wasn't.
It's very of its time.
It wasn't laugh out loud. Here I am clutching my side because I'm in stitches.
Because it was at the time.
And I can imagine that. And, you know, Eve probably was watching that en route to hospital when she had little baby William Goodings.
It was 1983, wasn't it?
1983, yeah. Mm. And Graham was probably at home waiting for the call that she was nearly there and he's laughing along to All Sperm is Good. But, yeah, the comedy itself, I can appreciate it. And obviously they're a clever bunch, but I found it funny and entertaining, but I wasn't actively laughing out loud for an hour and a half.
I wonder if... And I know what the reference point for people that were, say, 30 in 1983 is for their equivalent. So I don't know what reference material you use for comedy from 1923, for example. Mm. But I've got this funny feeling comedy is so, it's so of the moment. It's so of the time. It's the language that people were using. It's a great snapshot of, as you say, it's the issues of the moment in the way people were joking about them, or maybe they weren't allowed to joke about them, that... Divorced from the time in which it was made, I think they all suffer. The best of all of it.
And I've marked a lot of the comedies here quite harshly, except for Flying High, because I gave that 4 stars.
That's true.
And that was 1980s comedy.
Maybe some of it truly is timeless.
The scene I did choose was in the death installment of The Meaning of Life. You know, they go through right from birth up through till death. I actually found the entire 5-minute scene hilarious. I could have played the whole lot. Anyway, death himself knocks at the door of a dinner party. This is how it starts.
It's one of the little men from the village. Come in, please. This is Howard Katzenberg from Philadelphia. And his wife, Debbie. Hello there. And these are the Portland Smythes, Jeremy and Fiona.
Good evening.
This is Mr. Death. Well, do get Mr. Death a drink, darling.
Yes.
Mr. Death is a reaper.
The Grim Reaper.
Hardly surprising in this weather.
So he's still a reaper out here, do you, Mr. Death?
I am the Grim Reaper.
That's about all he says.
I know I said I wasn't laughing out loud, but I was just then. But the whole scene, he's standing there exactly as you picture, dark cloak, big axe-looking thing, and he keeps saying, I am Death. I am Mr. Death.
Is that when they offer they start talking about the cheese?
Yeah,
Stilton's awful.
Yeah, because he breaks the glass that he gives to them and he's, oh, we don't have any white wine, but we do have beer. If you'd like that instead, please join us. And then he has to say, I am Death. You are all dead. And then they start, how on earth did we all die? And he points to the salmon mousse with his bony little index finger quite long and says it was the salmon. And then the man says, oh, my God, did you use the canned salmon again? And then they all walk out. They all realize that they have all died. And then they follow him out to pass on, I guess. And they all decide to take their cars.
It's a brilliant scene.
They all drive off into the afterlife up in the sky and they've all taken these cars, which have all turned translucent as well. Anyway, the death scene I thought was very funny. Anyway, the Movie Bowl will be back next week when David returns. And who knows, maybe another Chevy Chase will get in there, maybe the Holy Grail.
So.
Dave on the text line says, the Holy Grail is the original and the best. Clearly you have to watch it. Well, Dave, we will see. Coming up after the 8:30 news with Kendall, we're chatting with Marsha Hines.
Hi, it's Eddie May here from NRG Solar. Home batteries for solar systems, are they all the same? Well, definitely not. At NRG Solar, we've spent thousands of hours testing different batteries. A great battery has plenty of power, runs your home in a blackout, and has an easy-to-use app that's very smart. Imagine having a battery that actually earns you money by buying electricity when prices are cheap and selling it back when prices are high. A 10-year warranty, blackout protection, and an awesome app for monitoring it on your phone. Want to know more? Visit nrgsolar.com.au today.
Cheese, crepes, wine, champagne. Merci beaucoup.
Friday's going to be fun. We're going to be at the Central Market for Bastille Day, and Lucy's going to be doing a lot more of that kind of stuff. Celebrate France's national holiday over two exciting days, this Friday the 14th and Saturday the 15th of July.
There is plenty lined up over the weekend, so grab tickets for the French walking tour and the paint and sip class, or you can enjoy free kids' activities and cooking demonstrations.
Not to mention the French wine bar, crepes and more with live music that's set to that timeless French bistro atmosphere.
Stock up on all your favourite French goodies this Friday and Saturday with Bastille Day at the Adelaide Central Market. Think baguettes, croissants, small goods and, of course, the cheese. Support local and get a taste of France. See the full program at adelaidecentralmarket.com.
5AA Breakfast is streaming live right now. To watch, simply head to 5AA on Facebook or YouTube.
This is Adelaide's 5AA.
Mostly sunny and 17 with the 8:30 news. I'm Kendall Brettig.
Woken with a stiff neck or sore back? Get a Physio Extra appointment today. 6 locations. PhysioExtra.com.
The Prime Minister has announced Australia will join Germany's elite climate club, declaring there's no greater challenge than the threat posed by climate change. Anthony Albanese is hoping the move will allow Australia to help shape the recently formed group's role in a way that's complementary to our climate objectives. He says it's another way to take forward our multilateral engagement on climate action.
Together with the G7, Argentina, Chile, Colombia, Indonesia, Netherlands and Luxembourg, we are united in our commitment to be ambitious about taking up the opportunities that come from acting on climate.
While Australia is dispatching one of its most sophisticated surveillance aircraft to Europe for the next 6 months, the Wedge Tail will help protect the delivery of military and humanitarian aid to Ukraine. About 100 Australian military personnel will be based in Germany from where the plane will operate. Two men have been arrested and police are searching for a third after a crime spree at Coffin Bay overnight. More from Abby Smith.
A supermarket on the Esplanade was broken into just before 2 a.m. with a white ute and three occupants seen fleeing the scene. Police pursued it, spiking its tyres as it headed towards Port Lincoln. The vehicle was dumped and the occupants ran into the Port Lincoln golf course. A 27-year-old and 18-year-old man were arrested and charged with aggravated serious criminal trespass, theft, engage in police pursuit, illegal use and hinder police. A large quantity of stolen property was also found in the ute, which was also stolen. Investigations are continuing.
An unpleasant clean-up operation for road crews at Paralowie this morning. A truck lost its load of chicken carcasses on Port Wakefield Road just before 2 a.m. The road has since reopened. Egg production by caged hens could be phased out 10 years earlier than expected if ticked off by agriculture ministers at a meeting this week. But it comes with a warning that prices could skyrocket and supply could drop if caged eggs are phased out by 2036 instead of 2046. National Senator Bridget McKenzie says a natural shift away from caged eggs is happening right now.
Over the last 10 years, we've seen the rise in the purchase of free-range egg happening automatically through consumer choice. And I'd be much more comfortable with that occurring over time rather than pressuring farmers and increasing the cost in the long term of this particular food source.
An extremely rare Grange wine collection has been put up for auction by a former Penfolds employee and is expected to sell for six figures. It features 60 extremely rare bottles of vintage wine and resembles a complete collection dating back to 1959. Lloyd's Auctions says it's attracting international attention. Now turning to 5AA Sport.
Get 10-year warranty and 10 years capped price servicing on the new Mitsubishi Outlander at Agostino Mitsubishi.
Here's Tom Wren.
Thank you, Kendall. Adelaide's players will hit the training track in the next half hour as they prepare for Saturday night's crunch game against GWS at home. The Crows will be boosted by the return of defender Jordan Butts after he missed last week through concussion. Essendon, meantime, faces a test this weekend when they take on Geelong at Cadinia Park. The Bombers are enjoying a resurgence under new coach Brad Scott. Their win over Adelaide on Sunday, seeing them jump up to fifth on the ladder. Bombers great Matthew Lloyd says there's currently a lot of belief in the coaching staff.
It's all coming off the back of what Brad Scott is doing in terms of the direction and the belief and the game style and the system, the development during the week, the strategy, that they're all blossoming and playing fantastic football, so they'll give it a shake Saturday night.
But the Bombers have been dealt a blow with Andrew Phillips offered a one-game ban for engaging in rough conduct, while Fremantle's Caleb Sarong is also set to miss a week on the same charge. Well, Ange Postecoglou will attempt to convince Harry Kane to stay at Tottenham when pre-season begins this week.
You know, I want him involved here. My conversation with him will be about how we can make this club successful. And I've got no doubt that that's what he wants as well. What I want is to introduce myself to Harry, to give him my sort of vision for the football club, to get an understanding from him of what he thinks this football club needs to be successful. And we'll go on that training pitch and try to make it happen.
Kane has attracted significant interest from rival clubs in Europe, with Bayern Munich among those making an offer to sign him. And in some tennis, Chris Eubanks has caused the biggest upset overnight at Wimbledon, beating Stefanos Tsitsipas in five sets. And that's the 5AA Sport.
Now to the traffic.
Well, Bruce, what are we to look out for this morning on the drive-in? You'll find one around the Adelaide Airport, Sondorna Bramber Drive, just opposite the golf club there. Speeds are down 40. Ebray, Bruce, what are there too? Glen Osmond Road at the bottom of the freeway. Sluggish South Road at Anzac Highway. Busy 5S Drive at Pasadena with cameras Lily Street, Blair Athol and Hawker Streets at Brompton. Friday, July 21 is National Pyjama Day. Wear your favourite pyjamas to work or school and help raise funds and awareness for children in foster care. Register at nationalpyjamaday.com. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
Pack away the boardies and bikinis, pull out the uggies and get your brakes checked at Automasters.
Mostly sunny and 17 today, more of the same on Wednesday and Thursday, tops of 17, and partly cloudy for Friday, also 17, at the moment 12. More news as it happens on 5AA.
to 5AA Breakfast, the singer of that fantastic song. It is, of course, Marsha Hines. Marsha, good morning to you. Welcome to the show.
Hey. Good morning, Lucy. How are you doing?
I'm very well, thank you. I'd like to congratulate you on a huge career. You've just released your 50th anniversary Ultimate Collection, Still Shining, came out on Friday to huge success. Just congratulations on a wonderful career to date.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. You know, it's really nice to still be working. It feels great. Yeah. Why the laughter, Will? Why?
a lot of people look forward to retirement, Marsha. I don't think that doesn't sound like you, though.
No. Look, until I become a total embarrassment to myself and my friends, I'll continue working. Will.
Well, you'll never retire then.
No, correct. I hope I can, you know, sustain this. But I mean, like, it's still fun, okay, guys.
Yeah.
So as long as it's fun, I'm good. When it becomes, you know, drab and, you know, boring, I'll just get out of here. You know, I won't do it.
You put a number on something and you talk about the years. It's a 50th anniversary ultimate collection of songs. I guess that invites you in the process of compiling it to reminisce a bit, doesn't it? Did you find yourself walking down memory lane a lot and putting this together?
No, not really. But, you know, it's interesting because we've got a live show at the moment of and the tour is called Still Shining.
Mm.
And I put a couple of new songs into the repertoire, not new songs, old songs, and a song I've not sung for years called Shining. And it just feels so good to sing it again. And I think I haven't sung it for 15 or 20 years. So it just feels so good to sing it, you know. And luckily, with the songs I have been able to record, I've been across them and I've chosen them. So I like them. So they're a part of me. They're kind of like the tapestry of who I am. So it feels great to watch the audience hear all those old songs again.
Why does that happen? When you love an artist and you've seen them a lot of times live, you'll sometimes note, oh, they used to play that song that I love, but they don't seem to play it so often. Is it just that you yourself sort of lose interest in it, or does it get...
No, it's not so... Well, it's not so much lose interest in it. It's the relationship you had with the song. You know, so every song has a memory, yeah? And so the memory of Shining wasn't a great memory for me. So I just thought, you know, I do love the song, but it's probably best that I just sort of like moonwalk away from it for a minute and see how I go. And it turned into a very long time, which, like I said, is 15 or 20 years. But now it actually feels new, fresh, and I feel happy singing it.
The rest of the songs on the album, Marsha, so would you say they are 20 of your career favourites, or are some of them more just about the memories they brought or when you created them? Are they your favourites?
Oh, they'd have to be favourites, yeah, sure. Especially if you put something together and you're celebrating, you know, this long in the industry. Yeah, they're part of me, you know, and the great thing, you know, about recording is... We are storytellers. Singers are storytellers. So everything you hear me sing, it's something I can either relate to, I've lived, or I've seen someone else live. You know, because, I mean, and we're nosy. So when I was writing one of my albums, I used to sit in a cafe and listen to people's conversations and then go back to my place and write songs, you know. So, yeah, you know. I shouldn't tell you that. But
no. Is there a song then? So, obviously, some of them have troubling memories and they elicit difficult emotions. Mm-hmm. Is there something on the other end of that spectrum, a song that you'd imagine it would never drop out because it just brings you, it'll always bring you joy because it's associated with such a happy memory?
Sure. It would always be Fire and Rain.
Yeah.
Because, you know, one, you never forget where they're coming from, you know, and that's the first thing I ever recorded. And I remember being petrified. And when I hear it, you know, I think, oh, God, who's that little girl? I can feel my voice trembling. I can hear my voice trembling and stuff like that. So Fire and Rain is still my very favorite because I talk to people about it when I'm doing my show, too. You know, like it was the reason I do Fire and Rain is because I was in Boston. And before I came to Australia, that was a huge hit in Boston. And I got to my accommodation here in Sydney after leaving Boston, and I turned on the radio, and that was the song that was on the radio, and I went, wow. If I ever get a chance to record a song, I'm going to record. Not to mention, I've got a huge crush on James Taylor. But, you know, those things. But he's a great songwriter, you know, and that's such an appropriate song for me at that point in time. It worked, you know.
That 16-year-old you that came out to Australia doing musical theatre, do you think, how did you change as an artist since then? Do you think that version of you would have imagined a 50th anniversary compilation album sounding like this, or would it have been...
Nah.
Yeah, okay.
No, 50 years, 6 months. No, I came to Australia, you know. I came to Australia just for only 6 months. And just the way it all sort of dovetailed into what I've become, I had no idea. And you know, strangely enough, when we were kids, nobody spoke about being a star. Nobody. Mm. We just spoke about being musicians. Just getting a gig would be nice, you know. Forget being a star. Mm. Just getting a gig, just getting a job, you know, singing with a band would be just like, wow. You'd be euphoric if you got that. But you know, like. The industry's changed so much. People talk about being stars and they've not even been on stage yet. You know, it's weird.
Marsha, you've played a huge role in many Australians' people's lives as your time in judging on Australian Idol. And excitingly, the reboot has happened and it's been announced only in the last few days that you will be heading back to Australian Idol next year as a judge.
Oh, girlfriend, I'm stoked. I'm stoked. I love that job. It was hard. Ooh, it was probably the hardest job I've ever done because... You know, there but for the grace of God go I. All those kids, they just wanted to be singers. You know, they just wanted to do what I do for a living, yeah? Mm. And they had been plucked from obscurity. And one of the best people we've ever had is Guy, who's from Adelaide.
Yep.
You know? So, you know, and I remember hearing him singing, what the? You know, that's just not normal singing. That's like on another level, you know, like AAA, you know? And it was hard. But it was really self-satisfying when you saw the light in the kids' eyes when you'd say something. And so being plucked from obscurity and everybody's got an opinion of you and they don't know you, it would have been hard. And I'd tell them, I'd speak to them on camera, and I'm sure they'd look at me and I'm thinking, you know what, you can't even hear me. You're like a deer in the headlights. You know, you can't hear me. You know, but and then after the show, I'd always sort of try and go and speak to them and when there were no cameras, you know, rolling because, you know, I have been successful because I've had good people around me and people who have encouraged me. And it's much nicer to be positive, give people positive feedback instead of being nasty. I see no need to be nasty. You got to think about being nasty. It's easy to be nice.
Yeah.
But when you know, when you think about trying to be clever and mean to somebody, why? No, for what? You know, I don't get it, but anyway.
I'm interested in the context of you talking about Idol and finding these kids that are unrefined and untouched and haven't necessarily been involved in the industry. They just want to sing and they want to perform. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in that in the context of your previous point about people down these days talking about being stars. Is that a generational thing? Will those kids you talk about it in the context of being stars, or is that something that happens once, you know, you get a brush with the industry and that's what...
Well, it all depends on your mindset. It all depends on, you know, and people ask me about being famous and stuff like that, and they say, oh, I've got a daughter that sings really well. And I say, oh, how old is she? Oh, she's 9 and a half going on 10. I said, oh, great. So my advice to you is don't make it a party trick. Leave the child alone, and if they're talented now, fingers crossed, they'll be talented when they're 17 or 18, when they can make up their own mind, yeah? That's what I usually say to people, because, you know, like, it's a very interesting job, but with the internet as it is, you can become, look at Justin Bieber.
Mm.
Yes.
You know, he became huge through the internet. You know, so a lot of people can just become incredibly famous, you know, through the internet, which is like, what? For me, it's like, huh? You know, where, you know, most of the people like John Paul Young, Daryl Braithwaite, me, you know, Renee Gay, we slogged it. You know, we went out to the pubs or whatever gigs there were to try and you know, get build up our profiles, whereas you don't have to do that anymore. But you should do it because I think it keeps you real.
Yeah.
You know, when you're the incidental thing and you're trying to perform and people are talking over you and drinking and, you know, hooting and how, you learn a lot. You learn a lot about trying to, you know, not so much control a crowd, but you have to stay firm within yourself with those sort of things. But, you know, par for the course.
Marsha, thank you so much for your time this morning. You've got a packed schedule at the moment right through New South Wales, going out into the regions, but thank you so much for giving us a bit of your time this morning.
You're more than welcome, Lucy. Hold fingers crossed I'll come to South Australia.
Oh, we would love to see you. You are welcome anytime, Marsha. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you both very much for your time.
Marsha Hines there. Her album, Still Shining, the 50th Anniversary Ultimate Collection, was released on Friday. Jump online, do a Google, find out where you can buy it, and jump onto 20 of her favourite career-defining tracks, plus an extra 2 digital songs that are brand new, of course. She was so wonderful, and of course we can see her next year on the 2024 Australian Idol judging panel.
Yeah, looking forward to that.
Let's check traffic for your run-in, and then we'll get to Best of Behind Closed Doors.
Thanks, Lucy. A couple of burst waterways to look out for this morning. One at the Adelaide Airport, Southern Rabba Drive, just opposite the golf club there. Speeds are down to 40 with one lane out of action. Another one at Erbrae, Glen Osmond Road at the bottom of the freeway. Slow South Road at Anzac Highway. Quite busy at the moment. Henley Beach Road at South Road with cameras this morning, Lionel Avenue, Blair Athol, and the North-South Motorway at Croydon Park. A massive $972 million could be yours with the USA Power Lotto. Hurry, draw closes in less than an hour. Grab your tickets now at lotteryoffice.com.au. Adelaide's most accurate traffic on 5AA.
It's a frightening thought, but what if you lost the capacity to manage your financial affairs? If you're not at the helm, who makes medical or health decisions? Who controls the family trust? From the simplest to the most complex wills and estate plans, Donlan Lawyers will answer your questions and help carry out your wishes. For wills and estate planning, visit donlanlawyers.com. That's donlanlawyers.com. Hindmarsh Square, Adelaide, and Ocean Street, Victor Harbour.
Tired of your rent and bills going up and up and up? Pump them down with EcoVantage. It's easy to switch your existing hot water system for an energy-efficient heat pump, even if you're renting. And thanks to federal and state government-facilitated subsidies, it could cost as little as $0. Start saving hundreds off your water heating costs. Hit up your landlord and ask for the EcoVantage switch. Visit ecovantage.com.au. T's and C's apply.
It's not every day a third-generation chef cooks you eggs on toast, but when you have breakfast at Jarma's Kitchen, that is exactly what you get from Chris Jarma, and it is spectacular.
Lovely bloke, great chef. It's a cracking breakfast menu as well. I've been there myself. Can't think of a better way to start your weekend. You can treat yourself to waffles with fried chicken and Harndorf bacon, or a delicious smashed avo.
Breakfast doesn't have to play by the rules down there at Jarma's. Try a brekkie schnitzel, a crumb chicken breast with Harndorf bacon, a poached egg and some hollandaise sauce.
It's tough to even read the menu without your mouth watering. Chris's buttermilk pancakes are irresistible. If you're on a health kick, he makes a mean granola, mixed berries and yogurt.
Your favourite, Will. I know what you'll be having this weekend, but give yourself the morning off. Well, maybe we won't just yet. We'll go on a weekend and let Chris handle brekkie. Book a table at jarmaskitchen.com.au. That is Jarma's Kitchen, fancy made easy.
What's the best thing about winter? Definitely the Bob Burns Blinds Winter Warmer Special. Get super cozy with up to 40% off. That's up to 40% off our entire range of curtains and blinds, including our energy-efficient window coverings. With Bob Burns Blinds, you'll get that quality show home look, and you'll save money on energy bills by trapping the heat in your home. Get set for winter now with a Bob Burns Blinds Winter Warmer Special. Book your free measure and quote at bobburnsblinds.com.au.
Hello, Frank Walker from National Tiles. Is your new home or renovation running over budget? National Tiles is here to help. Yes, National Tiles is checking and locking down prices on many of our popular tiles at more than 20% below the market every day of the year. That's right, get your new home or renovation back on budget with National Tiles checked and locked prices and save more than 20% below the market every day of the year. So rush into National Tiles now and save.
5AA Breakfast, Will Goodings and Lucy Loken.
The Cherry Emoda 5, state-of-the-art driving from 33K drive away with immediate delivery. Visit Cherry Glen Osmond.
8:50, we've got Graham Goodings coming up after the 9 o'clock news. But good news, if you are looking to do something this winter, give us a ring, 8223 0055. We have got tickets for you and a friend to get along and see Peak at Glenelg Winter Arts Festival. Shows, bars and festive fun at the Bay, July 6 to 23 in Collie Reserve. Get your tickets at glenelgwinterfestival.com or give us a ring and you can get along to see Peak.
Thank you, Luce. We've got some breaking news in the world of the AFL out of Melbourne. A host of outlets now reporting that Gold Coast coach Stuart Dew has been sacked with a year to run on his contract. The speculation had been rife that something may be in the offing. There have been denials from Dew and the club, but it will be made official at a press conference in a couple of hours' time. They, of course, lost to Port Adelaide over the weekend. A pretty enterprising first half, too. They looked like they might be in town to cause one hell of an upset. It wasn't to be. The week before, trounced by Collingwood. They beat Hawthorn the week before that, but got done by Carlton. So they lost three of their last four games. They had played a patch of decent footy when they beat the Bulldogs and the Crows in consecutive weeks, and it was had a feeling like they may have turned the corner, the Suns, but not the case. So he is out, and the speculation, I suspect, will reach fever pitch now that Damien Hardwick, the Richmond Premiership coach, will head there. He spoke in interviews recently about the itch to get back into coaching being strong. He's not the kind of coach that wants to take a few years out. Sounded like a man very much who wants to get back into it. And Gold Coast, they need, well, two things. They could benefit from a guy like Damien Hardwick because his record's impeccable. But the other thing I think here is, I feel for Stuart Dew because the problems with Gold Coast Suns go so far beyond him and his coaching. Coaches are a convenient scapegoat. Their club is stuffed. Their recruiting has been stuffed. Their ability to keep people has been stuffed. Their ability to attract people to watch their games is stuffed. I think culturally there are real issues there. And I would like to think that the people in positions of responsibility know it goes far beyond Stuart Dew. But coaches are easy. They release the pressure. You get rid of one, you bring in another one, you buy. Everyone buys themselves more time as associated with the decision. I always liked Stuart Dew as a coach. I hope he gets another gig somewhere later in a more functioning football environment to demonstrate what he's capable of.
What time was that press conference, did you say?
It hasn't been set, but in the next couple of hours.
Be this morning, no doubt. Before we get to behind closed doors, we were talking earlier about people losing luggage and the current stress of flying, even domestically through Australia at the moment. Daryl in Mount Barker's called in. Morning, Daryl.
Yeah, good morning, Lucy. Good morning, Will. Actually, Will, you raised a good point this morning, obviously being in service into the airport every day. This has been a bit of an issue, people getting off a flight late at night with lost luggage, nowhere to go to actually find anyone to give them some help.
They all clock off. Everyone goes home that works there.
It's unbelievable, Will. You know, these people the other day, they got told that they had to go to their final destination point before they could lodge a lost property report. Now, they got in very late into Adelaide. They'd been travelling from Europe, and they could track their baggage in the middle of Europe by their little app device. But nowhere in Adelaide Airport. Now, being in the service area to the airport every day, I would like to know that information where I can direct people.
Yeah, I bet.
To lodge this concern because, you know, they're absolutely exhausted and don't know what to do. But I think this is a valid point, Will, and I'm glad you raised it this morning.
Well, you know, I think it's an inconvenience, and it's, I think, by and large, consumers in Australia get treated with disrespect by our airlines. But beyond that, and probably more importantly, maybe not more importantly, I'll take that back. People that come to this country that we sell ourselves as a tourist destination's first impression is this place is a shambles. That's the impression you get from our airlines. And I say all that, not levelling it at any individual. I think people work hard. And I think 90% of times people that, when you don't get good service, it's because someone's overtaxed. It's because someone's had to work too long. It's because someone doesn't get the support they need. That generally is what's to blame. This is a management issue. It's not a people issue. There are good people that work at these airlines. They're just, overall, they're run in a way that doesn't befit a country like ours, I think.
Let's get to behind closed doors. Thanks to John Blake. All thanks to Aussie Fast Transport Solutions, interstate freight distribution, warehousing and local Adelaide couriers. Call Aussie Fast 13 13 64.
And when we get behind closed, come on the rising wind.
5AA Breakfast with Tom Wren and Lucy Loken.
Yes, great to start off with a bit of Jimmy Barnes there.
John Fogerty, Lucy.
Sorry?
Pretty sure it's John Fogerty and Creedence Clearwater Revival.
Right, well, I think a lot of older people would be thinking she's right. John Foggy and Clearwater MacGyver does sound somewhat like Jimmy Barnes.
Well, you might be right there, Lucy.
Good morning to you on this cold morning, another chilly start to the day. But the good news is we are into July, which means we're edging slightly closer to winter being over, which does happen when winter has just started. Every day is slightly closer to winter ending. So I wasn't completely wrong there. Absolutely thrilled this morning to be joined by a man who is wearing only a T-shirt and shorts. Good morning, Tom Wren.
Yes, good morning, Lucy. Yes, I've got the T-shirt on and the shorts, as you pointed out, and I should have dressed a bit more appropriately because later on today I'll be going along to the HR department to report you for pointing out what I'm wearing, which, if I did it to you, could be construed as harassment in the workplace. But let's not talk about that now because I don't have my lawyer present.
Yes, it's 6.8 degrees outside in the CBD. It feels like 5.9. And there you are in a T-shirt.
Well, I tend to go off to the gym after we finish here at 9 o'clock, and so that's why I'm dressed like this. But again, we shouldn't ever consider that because someone laughs along with you when you're making fun of them in the workplace doesn't necessarily mean that it's not abuse. It just means that you're laughing along because you're embarrassed, and I'm just making a note of that for the HR officer later.
But, Rennie, it's 6 degrees and not even a jumper.
Yeah. Well, that's an even bigger laugh, isn't it? Because I'm even more uncomfortable now with this barrage of workplace abuse that I'm getting from you. So,
and if you want to text in, you can on 044-808-1395. And you can check us out on the live stream on Facebook or YouTube. And you can see what Tom's wearing with his bright yellow T-shirt and leave a comment.
That's right, Lucy. Just writing all that down for the HR officer, getting the audience to make fun of me as well via the live stream. Or text in with your abuse on 0448 08 1395.
You've been bullying Rennie, have you, Luce?
It was not bullying. And the people on the live stream agreed with me in their shock that Tom Wren was only wearing a T-shirt and shorts while it was freezing cold outside and I was wearing about four layers and a coat.
He's a man of steel.
None of that was bullying. It was factual. I could see him in a T-shirt. He could see me in a puffer jacket, as could the audience. I will go to town defending my right.
Tell it to the
with
judge.
Being cold.
Tell it to the judge, Luke.
Graham Goodings is up after the 9 o'clock news, and Will, you and I will be back tomorrow morning from 6.
If you thought it was tricky to source a great deal on a new Volkswagen, think again. Mawson Lakes Volkswagen's demo clearance is on now. We've loaded up on a massive range of demo Volkswagens available for delivery right now. Loads of colours.